Tim.
Where's Rob?
I guess I guess I don't have Ron, so we'll just leave that.
I'm sure Ron will be here.
Thank you.
A little bit. I mean, I'm.
Let's call the Finance Committee meeting to order. We've got a lot to go through tonight, so we'll get started on our agenda. The first thing on our agenda is public comment. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to make a comment to the City Council? Okay, then we'll move right along. Now, just as a note to the council members, this is like a work session, so all council members can participate in the discussion, and we'll try to get a consensus on certain things, and then the Finance Committee will convene at the end, and we'll make those recommendations. And then those recommendations will go to the full council, and we'll vote on those at the full council meeting on December 3rd. So, first thing on our agenda is the Rice Hospital budget presentation. Gentlemen, if you would, please. You want to do it there, or do you want to do it sitting? Why don't you just sit there, I think.
For filming, it needs to be at the podium. Sorry.
We don't have the other mic?
Okay. Well, then we will be at the podium.
All right, they're fine. They're at the podium.
Good. Well, thanks. We are here, Bill Fenske and myself, to present our Rice Memorial Hospital organization-wide budget for 2013. We have presented this, and our board has actually approved this at a past board meeting. And I'm just going to make some brief comments and have Bill Fenske, our chief financial officer, kind of walk you through the document and what's in front of you. As I said, we presented this to our board. Prior to it going to our full board at Rice, we have a finance committee, which you folks are aware of, and we spend lots of time, not only with our budget every year, but with our normal monthly finance meetings, talking at length about finances, our financial situation, and going into lots of detail. But we also do present a financial report at the full board meeting, as well as presenting, as we do annually, a budget to our board, which we did in 2013. There are two pieces to our annual budget. There is an operating budget, and then there's a capital budget that we present to our board. Prior to that, every couple of years, we have gone through the exercise at Rice of putting together what we call a five-year financial plan, which really is done, and it's not done every 5 years. It's done more frequently than that. But we do take the time to really plan ahead and look at and talk about what trends are, looking at what history has shown us as far as volume trends, expense trends, all factors included, as well as planning for capital, what we're doing currently with capital projects, as well as what we're planning for down the road with future capital projects. And all those factors are included in that five-year financial plan and incorporated into that. We went through that exercise this past year with our board as well. And so as we go through the documents, and Bill can allude to a few more of the details, you will see, or have it alluded to in the report, it references our five-year plan, and we've deviated from some of those for 2013, and there's rationale and reasoning behind that. What I would just say in opening up here is that the first part of your packet is really a significant part of what drives the budget and what we look at within administration, what we spend a lot of time with our board talking about. And these are key indicators that really drive the volume, key assumptions in different areas that really drive the volume, revenue and expenses, to get at the overall financial picture with a budget, whether it be a budget in 1 year in 2013 or, again, our five-year plan, as I referenced. And so capital is included, depreciation, all those kinds of things are included. And they're actually more in detail as we get to the consolidated statements toward the back part of the packet. But we spend a lot of time talking about key margins, key indicators, things that really drive the revenue and expense, and our key targets that we want to operate within with parameters of the budget. So as you look on page one, there's a memo from Bill and myself to the city of Willmar. This was similar to what we presented to the board. There's a narrative portion of it, pages one and two, that talk about that, and then we get more into the process and narrative in page three about the process that we go through every year. I would just say, as an organization, we spend a lot of time working through the process of our budget, both capital budget planning process as well as our operating budget, with department directors that funnels up and we work within administration before it's presented to our finance committee of the board as well as to the full board itself. And then tonight as we're presenting this informational report to the city council. Back to pages 1 and 2 though, these in the box at the bottom as well as the box at the top of page 2, these are key indicators that really we've talked a lot about, certain thresholds that we set in various areas, from operating margin percentage to things like EBITDA ratio, which we can explain as we go through this, debt to capitalization, which speaks to how much debt we have on our balance sheet and on the books, as we're also planning for future projects and looking at capital and future debt financings and so forth, how strong we are with liquidity with our balance sheet. We've improved significantly over the past few years, the strength of our balance sheet, but we want to be at certain thresholds as it relates to things like net days and receivables and days of cash on hand. That's an important thing for us. And as I said, we've made progress and over the past number of years, and we want to continue to make progress down the road. We've set certain targets within our five-year plan. And then as we get into page 2, those kinds of ratios and so forth speak to how productive, for instance, we are with utilizing our manpower and resources at the top. Certain FTE ratios, FTEs per adjusted admission, per adjusted patient day, and so forth. And then we get into some other expense ratios as it relates to staffing and so forth. The balance of that narrative really speaks to key assumptions that are in, that are part of the budget as it relates to both inpatient activity as well as outpatient activity. And as we've talked a lot about in the past couple of years, we're dealing with a lot of trends today in healthcare that are very prevalent, and that is the shift from inpatient to outpatient. That has a big impact on us as a healthcare organization, and we're always looking at ways that we can make sure that we're efficient and effective, providing good, high-quality care to our patients. But the reality is there continues to be a shift from the inpatient side of taking care of patients to services that are delivered in the outpatient setting. That has an impact on the reimbursement as well. And so all those things are factored in to the equation. But as we also look at the historical, again, dating back 5, 6, 7 years, our inpatient census was much higher 5, 6, 7 years ago than it is today. And we're budgeting, as you can see, in the neighborhood of 32, for instance, where we've been this past year and moving into 2013. So all these assumptions really drive the revenue and expense. That's what's really laid out for you. And I'm going to let step aside at this point and just let Bill kind of walk you through the document, what's all included in there, and then we'd like to answer questions that that anybody has today.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mike. One additional comment I'd like to make about the memo, and we show our 2013 budget compared to our 2013 five-year capital plan number or five-year financial plan numbers that we had shared with the Finance Committee, I think probably like a month or so ago. Mm-hmm. Is the five-year financial plan was based off of our 2011 actual numbers and what we thought 2012 would look like. When we first started working in the five-year financial plan, that was first part of 2012, and we actually ended up getting done with it sometime midsummer. And so once we saw some of our changes in our volumes in 2012, we felt we had to reflect a more realistic 2013 budget. And so the numbers are not exactly tied. Some of our key indicators are. But if you recall from our discussion a month ago, we talked about some of the key drivers of our five-year financial plan. One of them, we would never get below a 2% operating margin. Another one, we would never get above a 45% debt to capitalization ratio. Another one was our days of cash on hand, where we would always want to be pushing our days of cash up by about 10 days a year. And then our last ratio was our unrestricted cash to debt ratio, where we would continue to be increasing that number and eventually try to get to a 1-to-1 ratio by 2017. Our 2013 budget encapsulates all of those major assumptions and major guidelines still in here. Not quite what we were hoping for with when we did the five-year plan, but volumes had dropped off so much during 2012 that we just didn't feel that we could reflect a 2013 budget based off of what we thought was going on 9-10 months ago. And that's why we're a little more conservative with the numbers and what we feel is a little bit more realistic. I'm going to move on. Pages 3 and 4 really are just the process that we go through. This process doesn't change. We've been incorporating this process for the past many years, but it just is an idea for you about how do we develop the budget here for Rice in our operating budget and in our capital budget. So what I'd like to do then is to go through the document and refer you to each of the different pages and to let you know what that page is about. I'm not going to talk about anything detail on that page unless, of course, you have any questions. And certainly if there's a question that we need to kind of step back and go back in the document, just feel free to ask, and we'll go answer those questions as you have them. So the first tab is our statistics, and which is found on page 5 of the document. We go back. One thing that I think is very helpful is to show a lot of data when we look back at some of this, and we can see some of our trend lines and what is going on. Mike talked about how the trend of Rice is continually pushing more to the outpatient side from the inpatient side. And I think as you look at some of our statistics, you see that as our inpatient census has been going down since 2007. Actually, it's been going down since about 2002. We can see that. And that's where we keep, if we see those kinds of trends, then we try to react to them and we try to project going forward. So you can see what's going on in page 5, all of the statistics and volumes that we're projecting for 2013, how they compare to our 2012 projections, and then how each of the prior years compare to each other as well. The next tab, which is tab 2, and it starts on page 6, we get into our financial statements. The very first financial statement is our consolidated balance sheet, which we show all of our assets and liabilities of the organization. The big thing that we do here is this page here drives our ratios. It drives the days of cash on hand, what our receivables are, what our net, our debt to capitalization ratios are. That's why this document is so important, is to see are we hitting those thresholds and our ratios, our key indicators, like we have projected them to be. So this shows what our balance sheet is looking at for next year as well. On pages 7 and 8 is the consolidated income statement. This shows the entities within Rice rolled up. It shows the hospital, the care center, and Rice Home Medical all rolled up into one entity. And it shows also the activity of Willmar Medical Services and all the ins and outs that go with that that entity that we're a joint venture in. We go back on page 7. We show what the actual raw numbers are going back to 2007 and projecting forward to 2013. Where we show total revenues of around $207 million. Our net revenues, or our total operating revenue, which is $105 million. That number really represents, that's the amount of cash that we anticipate is going to come in the door to pay for the expenses, that $105 million number. Go through all of our expenses there. We deduct out what are the Willmar Medical Services expenses are, because those get transferred over to the joint venture, because the joint venture pays for them, and then the profitability comes back in. And so we're projecting, third line from the bottom, our net operating income for 2013 is projected to be $2.5 million. That's the number, that's the target we look at very closely, because that's the number we can have the most control over, is what our operating margin is. The next line below that is our non-operating revenue. That relates to investment income, gains or unrealized gains or losses on our investments, depending on what the market is doing and the bond prices are doing. And so adding those two numbers together, we end up at about a $3.4 million bottom line, or a net income number. On page 8, we do a lot of comparisons with our percentages. We show what each of those line items is as a percentage of total operating revenue, and then we show what the percent change is from year to year. What this does, it kind of gives you a flavor for looking at all the raw numbers. Do the percentages look right? Do they add up, meaning is our salaries and wages as a percent of our total operating revenues really significantly different than the prior year this page will show that as well. On the very far right, we show just what our change is from one year to the next. On page 9 is a brief consolidated cash flow statement, which shows what our inflows and outflows are going to be for next year. We have our sources of cash and investments. Our sources are projected to be $13.7 million next year. Included in that is $1.9 million of borrowing. That relates directly to the Rice Care Center activity that we've already started. And then under uses, we have $10.7 million of uses, predominantly made up of property, plant, and equipment and our debt payments. And so on line 16, row 16, we show what we are projecting for an increase in our cash and investments next year of just a little over $3 million. So at the end of the period, we'd end up going from $34 million to $37 million in cash and investments. Turning to the next section is tab 3, which is our key indicators. The primary key indicators that we view as the most important are found on page 1 in the memo and page 2. But we show what all the detailed numbers are and all the different ratios are on page 10 and page 11, which shows the changes. So I'm not going to go through any of those in any further detail because they're really the meat of the numbers that we look at the closest. The key indicators are found on pages 1 and 2. And then the very last tab is our capital budget, which is found on page 12. We break our capital budget into different areas. We have routine expenditures. This goes to buy diagnostic equipment, surgical equipment. It goes to, for some minor renovations, things like that. And then it gets into our projects that we're looking at. Remember, we are already underway with the renovation of the Rice Care Center. That project right now is what we call Project C, and that has a price tag of about $2.4 million related to that. We'll get that done sometime in the middle of 2013, and then in October we'll start on Project D, and then that's another couple million dollar expenditure, and then in October of 14 we'll get on to Project E. All of those dollars are incorporated into this capital budget, as well as some of the renovations that we're looking at our home medical stores here in Willmar, Redwood Falls, Alexandria, and Madison. So that would be our 2013 capital budget, with a total budget that we're projecting for next year of about $8.8 million in capital expenditures. And so with that, that's the packet that we'd like to share, and of course we'll answer any questions you may have.
Thanks, guys. Okay, do we have any questions from the council on anything related to their budget? Mr. Mayor.
I do see that you're doing more profit with less patient count. How do you do that?
Well, the patient count that I believe you're referring to is the inpatient count.
Yes.
The outpatient count, which is not as relevant of a number, meaning how many outpatient visits do we have. As you know, it's somewhere in that 70,000-80,000 range, meaning that's how many encounters we have. Mm-hmm. We're doing more of those, that type of business, than we are the inpatient. The only one we really measure are the inpatient, the average daily census, and that's that 32 number that Mike referred to. More of that business has moved to the outpatient. And we don't count outpatient visits in our projections because they're not a real good indicator of what's actually happening. And here's a good example. You may have an outpatient surgical case, and you may have an outpatient rehab visit. They both count as an outpatient visit, significantly different in the amount of charges that are generated. And that's why we don't count them that way.
Okay, thank you.
That answer that?
I think so.
Okay.
Councilmember Dockin.
Thanks for coming. I know we went from 32.9 to 32. That's going to be how solid, how convinced are you that 32 is a good number?
Well, I wish we had even if it was a cloudy crystal ball, that would help us. The difficulty that we have is the numbers just are, they move around all the time, and it's very difficult. And we took the approach in the 2011 budget of trying to be conservative with our inpatient census and trying to kind of get ahead of it so that we would staff down to a low number, and then at, if volumes were higher, then we would staff back up. That happened in 2011. Will we be below 32 in 2013? We don't think so, because of where we've been seeing our numbers for most of 2012, that they've been fairly steady, fairly flat. But it's possible. I mean, there's the ever-changing technology that we have in front of us of shifting more and more business from inpatient to outpatient is always pushing downward on that inpatient census number. And that's always a struggle of, you know, what's going to happen next year? Is this surgical case going to only be done on the outpatient side? And we don't know those. We don't know that right now. But we do believe that 32 is a reasonable number for us, and we do believe that we're going to be in that range for our inpatient average census.
Okay. What sort of an impact do you think the Affordable Care Act is going to have on that number? Anything at all?
I think it's too soon to tell. I think it's too soon to see what's going to happen with our regional players and how they are going to be doing working with the Affordable Care Act. So I think right now it's too soon to tell, because one thing about that, Jim, is there are so many different moving parts with the Affordable Care Act that we may actually end up, and some people are speculating, we may end up seeing more volume because more people are insured. Even if they're insured through governmental means, they may still be more insured, which may end up actually pushing our volumes up. So I think it's right now it's a little early to tell. And Mike, I don't know if you'd have anything more to add.
Yeah, and I would agree with that. It's going to be a number of years until we start to see the full impact that the president signed into law a few years ago. The timing of when that will happen. I think there's no question that cost, quality, I think as healthcare providers, everybody would be first in line to say the cost issue is an issue. We're being judged, and we'll be much more moving forward based on already on transparency. You're seeing more and more information about quality and outcomes and information on different websites about how we as healthcare providers are performing. Now, that train left the station some time ago, and those are things that we're going to continue to work on, but getting at the cost of care as well, along with good outcomes are themes that providers are have been and will continue to work on, so I think we worked on right. But I think in reality, all of the impact that will come with the Affordable Care Act, it's going to be several years until we understand fully how that's going to impact us as well as other providers.
Okay.
Thanks.
Other questions? Councilmember Ahman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Bill.
Mm-hmm.
It was good to have you guys here once a year. We should maybe get together more time, but I'm not on the finance.
Steve, so excuse me. Will you pull your mic in?
Thanks. Is that better?
I hope so.
Okay. On page two, you make note of close scrutiny. Where was that? In the middle of the page, mm-hmm. Average census. Close scrutiny regarding expenses is what I'm sure you're delivering. You don't want to expand on that at all.
Well, the close, and it's really relating to our largest expenditure, which is staffing, and just making sure that on a daily basis we're staffing to what the volumes are, versus not staffing to what we thought they were going to be or were hoping them to be. So that means if our patient census, and let's just use that 32 number, is at 25. We're staffing for 25 today. We're not staffing for 32, because that's what our budget says. That's what that close scrutiny is that daily interaction between the manager and the staff, and making sure we're staffing to what our activity is.
And not overstaffing, all right,
yep.
Thank you.
And the other thing related to that is, if our census is at 40, we're staffing for 40, not 32. We're pushing up the staff to bring in staff, saying we need more staff today because our patient demand is higher than what we had thought.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. On page 3, you have mention of, I don't know if this is a new policy if established or not, but it's related to the $15,000 expenses approved by the appropriate executive. And on page 12, you have $450,000 appropriated for that. Is that something new?
No.
Okay.
No. What the $15,000 is a calculation that we use. It's based on some industry guidelines, based on what our overall business is. Anything over that, we project in a capital budget, and then we prioritize. I set a threshold of how much capital dollars we should spend in any given year, once again, based on industry guidelines, and then give that to our capital budget allocation committee, and they look at all expenditures over $15,000. Items less than $15,000, the executives are given budgeted dollars so they can make those decisions on a daily basis. We may have a scope that breaks down this afternoon. It needs to be ordered today, and maybe we'll get it tomorrow or Wednesday. It can't wait until, you know, a month from now when we have a meeting. It's got to get done right now. And so we try to have that balance of making sure that we have the tools and the equipment we need for the operation, yet there is some sort of control and prioritization process.
Okay, and all those reports are brought into your monthly meetings, I'm sure.
Well, as an executive team, we review that on a monthly basis. Yep.
The other one I was on page 5.
Mm-hmm.
On the item number 3245, the
ERCP is fine.
ERCP is fine. I don't use that word in my vocabulary often.
No.
It's down 42.5%. It just struck me when I went through the percentages. That's the first thing I look at, and I'm just curious what that's related to.
It's an endoscopic type procedure that a couple of our physicians, really primarily one, Dr. Body, does. And that really is just depending on where the volume, where the caseload is at. More and more of those endoscopic procedures are being done on an outpatient basis, so they're more and more are being done over at the Willmar Surgery Center.
Okay. That explains, I see the
yeah.
It was down 79%
yeah.
in 2010,
down,
and I'm
right.
just wondering why it was such fluctuation.
Yeah.
Okay. Page 70, underneath utilities, you have, I believe, I'm assuming that you might have looked at the overall utility cost in your budget of $1,717,000 for utility costs. Is that taken into consideration the potential sewer increase
yeah.
rates might be coming in?
Yeah.
That's all I
question. Yeah, we one thing we do, and it's a good point, if you don't mind me elaborating a little bit, is we'll have our department directors, and in this case, that would be John Hillerin, will go and he'll talk to counterparts over at utilities and say, what are you guys looking at? Of course, we knew what the water and sewer is because that's been well known. We'll talk, see about what other kinds of increases we're looking at. Maybe we're looking at increases in some of our other buildings where it's not on the central steam. We'll call XL Energy. What are you guys looking at? In order for us to get some as good a guess as if we can get.
Right, it's a budget.
Yeah,
thank you.
It's a budget, that's right.
Appreciate it.
But that's what we do with, and we do that with all of our line items. Mm. The director of pharmacy, she contacts the drug reps that they have. What are you guys looking at for next year?
That hasn't been I don't know how specific it had to be because we haven't made that decision yet. We just had our meeting on the sewer.
Yeah, list. And.
So I'm sure you're close.
Yeah, and we try to be a little, we try to be conservative on it and try to budget the increase a little high.
Right. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
I have one question. Willmar Medical Services, I mean, that's a big contributor to the bottom line. And I've kind of lost track of what all is included in that. I know the surgery center is, but what makes up Willmar Medical
Services? Well, there's really three main service lines. The surgery center is one of them. Oncology is another one. That is made up of medical oncology, chemotherapy, and radiation therapy. And then the third one is medical imaging. And that's made up of your regular imaging, ultrasound, nuclear medicine, CAT scans, MRIs. And so those are the three main service lines. There are a couple other minor things that are in there, but those are the three major service line initiatives that are part of Willmar Medical Services.
Okay, good. Thanks. All right, we have any more? Rick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Bill and Mike, for coming. On page 12, the 2013 capital budget, what's home medical routine for $400,000? And then you got Willmar, Alec, and Madison. And then you got contingency. Is that for the Redwood office?
Okay, let me do one at a time. The home medical routine, that's really broken down into two different parts. One is our everyday operating needs. Most of that are vehicles, the delivery vehicles, because they're going all over the place. So most of the one piece of that is that. The other part of that is we have rental equipment that we rent. We will rent out a hospital bed. We'll rent out a wheelchair. We'll rent out this or rent out that. Those are classified as capital expenditures when we buy them, and then we rent them out. So all of the new beds that we have to buy, because we have to replace beds on a regular basis, or the chairs, or oxygen concentrators, that's all part of that routine number. So that's that. The other home medical, Willmar, Alec, Madison, those relate to the store renovations, the actual building renovations that we are projecting to do in 2013.
Okay.
And then the last item, the contingency that you asked for, that's the overall organizational contingency, so that we put aside some dollars because some things just happen. And some things just, you know, a lab analyzer that costs $250,000 breaks down and we determine we have to replace it. Then as an executive team, we will gather and we will talk about that, and then we'll make a decision, and those dollars come out of that pot of money. And so it's kind of the contingency dollars never get used up. There's always dollars that are still there at the end of the year, and we don't carry them over. So if they're not, you know, if they're not needed, then we start over at zero again. But that's what that number is. Okay. Each of those project numbers have some contingency dollars in them, Rick, but they're all part of the overall project budget.
So you might not use all that money for renovation for each of the stores?
Maybe not.
And then, do you have a store in Redwood Falls that's still operating in its old location?
No, not in its old location. We have the old location we vacated, and we moved to a new location, which is it's kind of in the industrial park area. And we plan on breaking ground on a new store on Highway 7119 in April.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then are you seeing more competition for home medical supplies from other companies then?
We're seeing more competition with oxygen and from the major players, which is, that's fine. We are continually trying to push toward a strategy of more cash sales. And so we're building our product line and our service line along that route rather than the government source route of oxygen concentrators and rentals and that.
Mm-hmm. Pressure continues to be there with that, although it's still important for us and for the service provider. The thing we look at is we're looking at ways to grow, finding ways that we can offer services and products that consumers, customers need, but some that are less dependent on government resources too. Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other? Yes, okay, now I'd like to kind of wrap this up. Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Bill and Mike, for coming. Mm-hmm. Non-payment, how was that trending?
Well, let me, if you don't mind, are you referring also to charity care included in that, as part of that?
That's a good question.
Or you're not sure?
I wasn't thinking of that.
No. When we look at our overall non-payments. We include uncompensated care, and we include our bad debts. And the difference is we have guidelines that uncompensated care, if they meet financial guidelines, we write off their care because they, mm-hmm. we just know they don't have the ability to pay. Bad debts are referred to as people who are unwilling to pay. And what we're seeing is that we, over the last 2 or 3 years, our uncompensated care was going up significantly. This past year is leveled off a little bit. And so we've seen kind of a little bit of a shift, and our bad debts are starting to rise. On an overall basis, the dollars are going up. The non-payment dollars are going up. But when we look at our benchmarks where we compare against industry, we're in that a 2% range of our revenues that are not collected. The industry is around a 6%.
Wow.
So we're significantly lower in that the people that we serve want to pay their bills, and they have the means to, more of them have the means to pay.
That's good news.
Yeah, it's very good news.
One other item, when we built the new wing in the hospital, the remodel job, I'm sure we did some you did some projections as far as patients per day, and, yeah. and I'm just curious as to how that turned out. I'm sure it isn't rising like you project, but what can you give me an example, or you don't have it?
Well, I think probably the biggest example is when we look at our inpatient census. Back in the late 90s, when the building project was projected, we were running in the mid 55 to 60 average daily census. Meaning that's how many people we had in the house on any given day. We're, not quite half of that. We're about 32 right now. Now, that's changed a little bit because, as we talked earlier, we're seeing more outpatients. So there's a lot of activity there. But the numbers have changed from when we first projected back in the 90s of what an inpatient census might be. And that has gone down significantly. And so that's where we're working on, well, how do we adjust to that where more and more business is being done on the outpatient side, and how do we meet the needs of our outpatients?
One thing to add to that, though, to the question is, we made projections back before that major building project years ago, and the experience since then, there have been some changes, safe to say, in volume and what we've seen. But one of the things that you don't see,
Well, here, come on up here if you want.
It's not reflected, and you don't see that in these numbers. Where we've seen a pretty dramatic shift in the past couple of years is, to the comment of inpatient versus outpatient, is even patients in beds. We've been running an average of about 32 acute patients per day. That's our average daily census. And those are the numbers that we project as we look at a five-year plan, as we look at an annual operating budget and those types of things. What you don't see, and where there's a dramatic difference in reimbursement, however, is the fact that we take care of, on average, daily, of about anywhere from maybe six, half a dozen to 10 patients that are in the hospital, they're in a bed, but they're in observation status. There's a fairly dramatic difference in reimbursement in what we get paid per day for a patient that's in observation status versus a patient that's actually admitted under general inpatient status. But the reality is, while there are 32 in an average census, you see those numbers, that's what drives a lot of that revenue. We likely have 40 or 45 patients who are actually in beds who are taken care of. Now, the challenge from our standpoint as a healthcare provider is, again, the reimbursement is dramatically different, but those patients that are in observation status, they're in there for a reason. They don't meet criteria, and Medicare, CMS has clamped down on the criteria in the past couple of years mm-hmm. in what patients actually do meet criteria to be admitted as an inpatient. They don't consume any less resources. In fact, they might consume more. That's that time, 2-3 day period where the physician's trying to figure out what the diagnosis is, what the patient, what the issue with the patient is. And so they don't require any less nursing care. They don't require necessarily any care at all. If anything, maybe more. But we've seen a big shift in the past couple of years from inpatient to observation status. So there's more to the story, too, than just the actual numbers you'll see in inpatient census and so forth. But I think that's worth noting, too.
So is the reimbursement considerably less? I mean, a whole lot less?
Yeah, considerably less, yeah.
It's about 10% of the acuity.
Okay.
90% less.
Okay.
What we used to admit a patient for that was acceptable is those criteria have really been clamped down upon. So that patient likely is in observation status today. So the reimbursement is dramatically different.
How about 5 years from now? What do you project for patients per day? I mean, I'm getting off the subject of the budget here a little bit. I'm just curious. I mean, because we see what it's done the last 10 years.
It's I think, you know, back to the question about the Affordable Care Act, it's hard for us to predict even 2 years from now, let alone 5 to 10 years from now, what things will look like. Technology has driven a huge shift from inpatient to outpatient. That's a good thing in most respects, although there's a cost to it, investing in that technology and so forth. But I think it still remains to be seen at what point, and we've been talking about this for the past couple of years, at what point does the inpatient volume, for instance, plateau out and or we start to see some increases. I think at some point with our baby boomer population, aging, with the numbers of patients we're taking care of, that we're still going to take care of patients on an inpatient basis, and despite the fact that more and more are being taken care of on an outpatient basis, there's still going to be that need, and at some point we may be taking care of more patients. The trend might be going in a different direction, but I think we've continued to see the trend at this point that more and more proportionally is being taken care of on the outpatient basis, and our inpatient census has been going down. We've experienced that, maybe not quite as fast as some smaller facilities, for instance, in this region that have experienced it sooner than us, but the trends we're experiencing aren't unlike what other facilities or other healthcare organizations in the state of Minnesota and across the country are experiencing.
Okay, once again, thank you both for coming. It's always interesting to hear your observations and get the information, albeit once a year, but thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
One last question. Councilman Bleek.
Thank you. Senator Anderson, just a question on physician recruitment and retention, and is there any new services out there we could be providing that we're not doing currently that may bring more business into the hospital?
You know, first of all, on recruitment, just a question about recruitment. Recruitment's an ongoing process, just like we work hard on quality improvement and all the things within our walls and working in partnership with our clinics. It's an ongoing process. We are always recruiting, whether it be for primary care or various subspecialties within the community. We're working hard on areas like orthopedics now, where we know we need a couple, 2-3 more orthopedists in the community. We as Rice work hard to partner with and support our two clinics, which are the main employment platforms for physicians within the community. We employ some ED docs, psychiatry as well, but otherwise our clinics are our main platforms for employment for physicians. And so we are always talking about what our needs are for recruitment. We've added some new specialties within the past few years. We have a new infectious disease specialist on our active staff that just joined us within the past month or two, who's employed at ACMC. That's a new addition to our active staff, a new subspecialty that we haven't had in past years. We think there's There's value to that. We've really beefed up our hospitalist service at the hospital. We work in partnership with ACMC on those particular physicians, and that's a fairly new service within the past several years that has been well received. Lots of primary care docs don't necessarily want to take care of a full gamut of inpatient as well as outpatient work in their practices today. A lot of the newer physicians don't. So we're always assessing what our needs are and talking about what our needs are as it relates to recruitment. So it's an ongoing process. We've made progress in the past few years, but we've still got areas where we've got needs, things like our cancer center for oncologists as well as orthopedics and other subspecialties.
Okay. Dennis, thanks. Can I just make one more comment?
Yeah.
Thanks. In addition to what Mike just said, Ann Polta had a really nice article after our last trustee meeting. It said there are several bright spots in the financial picture, however. The hospital's balance sheets remain strong. Rice has tightened its revenue cycle, resulting in better collections, and maybe Mr. Schramm can talk about that, of payment for services and less bad debt. By the end of this year, $1.2 million incentive payment will arrive from the federal government, the reward for the hospital's implementation this year of an electronic medical system called Epic that meets the meaningful use criteria. Rice Care Center, the skilled nursing facility owned and operated by the hospital, is also beginning to see the impact of adding therapy suites, a short-term stay unit that provides rehabilitation services and care. The demand has been so strong that therapy suites has had to turn people away because of it's at its capacity. So they are really doing their work over there, I believe.
Okay, I think that's a good way to wrap it up. And again, thank you, gentlemen. And I'm sure if we have additional questions, we can always contact you to get the answers. But again, we really appreciate all that you do for the community and for this fine report. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Now we'll go to the municipal utilities, Wes, and Dave. And would you please introduce Tim and tell us a little bit about Tim? I see he's here, but just give us a little
info. Actually, I'm just going to do the first initial stuff if I could. And but Tim Hunstead is a brand new director of finance who just joined us 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago. 4 weeks, and he just completed his first financial statement for the MUC here today at our meeting as well earlier today, and getting his way around the computer system in the office, and he's doing a wonderful job. He's got a lot of experience in our industry, so we are very lucky to have him on board. So anyway, welcome, Tim, to Willmar.
Yes, we'd like to welcome Tim. This is the first time the full council's had a chance to welcome you, so welcome to the city.
And I'm just going to do kind of an opening statement as well and get out of the way, because the meat and potatoes really is going to come from Wes. My name is David Baker. I'm the current president of the Municipal Utilities and proud to be of the commission that has worked really pretty hard this last year. If you recall, a year ago, we weren't sitting too pretty in front of the council and the finance department, finance committee, and we apologize for that. So again, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for letting us be here, Mr. Mayor, and the council. I also want to just thank you for your support over the last year. It's been a rough year for the MUC, and we've gone through a whole lot of dark days earlier in the year, but I will tell you the last 6 months have been really good days, and I will give a lot of credit to our staff, the manager, Wes Hopp, that we decided to choose as our general manager and our new leader, is going to do an amazing job, and the first indications are that everything's off to a really good start. So again, without the support of the council that we needed earlier on in these days, it was really helpful. I also want to point out how much support in the background I got from Charlene Stevens. You know, there was times through the darkest days when I didn't know when to talk, when to breathe, when to sneeze. I mean, but she was really helpful to say, let's make sure we talk to the mayor and the council about this, keep them in the loop. And her advice and her administration behind the scenes were very helpful for me during those times. So, again, we're here today to Mike and Bill did a wonderful job presenting a very polished thing. This is their first time at this. And again, we're kind of getting the new guys up to speed, if you will. But the MUC is in very good hands. We're proud to say that the $1.9 million contribution that we make to the city this year will be in lieu of taxes. Is on target. We're going to exceed our budget. There's no reason to think that 2013 will be the same. I think we are in a position where We aren't planning on any increases at this point of any electricity rate increases or water rate increases. However, we don't want to make any promises that we can't keep, because we've learned a hard lesson a couple years ago, or about 18 months ago, that when we took the 2.7% increases in 6-month period, we delayed it too long, and we don't want to do that again. So I think that the MUC, the commission, and the leadership team wants to make sure those kind of decisions get made timely, so we don't have any big hiccups. So again, we're happy to be here with the budget, and Wes will be here to present it. If there's any other questions you have, I know that Wes and Tim will be here to answer that. So again, thank you.
Thank you. Well, welcome, Wes.
Thank you, Dennis. Yeah, thanks for all the help. I appreciate the introduction that David put together for us. As I handed out just previously, I do have a slight change in the capital budgets. The one front sheet is a power plant, and the bottom last entry is a fairly sizable entry, and that is our power plant improvement project. We were granted permission in March of this year to do the project within the next 5 years, and you see that in the narrative on the budget overview. So we have that scheduled, at least slated in as a placeholder for 2016. That's the only change in that group that I gave you. As Dave said, this last year has been a year of quite a bit of changes. We've been more of a reactive than a proactive mode. The overview that I gave you, hopefully you had time to read that. I'm not going to go over it word for word. I know this is going to be a long meeting anyways. We're lucky to have very good people coming on board. One of them, Tim, has really shown that he's got quite a bit of experience and a very proactive way of going about the accounting function and the financing. His experience is going to come in very handy very soon. Being here just 1 month, he's still getting up to speed, so I'm not expecting him to stand up here and give you everything that Bill has done. He did a fine job. But as far as the budget coming up, we are looking at using these fresh sets of eyes to move forward and take a look at the way we operate and if there's any ways of making things more efficient and better as we move forward. So our financial performance is mainly dependent upon the cost of power being the largest piece of our operating budget. And in 2012, MISO, the Midwest Independent Transmission System Operator, market power was lower than we had expected. Mainly that's a function of the price of natural gas and the economic activity in the upper Midwest. Both of those have been fairly depressed. In the Willmar area, we've been lucky where we've had a fairly strong agricultural economy that's helping out Willmar. So our power prices have gone down a little bit from what we had budgeted, and you can see that in our operating statements. However, during the year, we entered into a contract with CMMPA, Central Minnesota Municipal Power Agency, and we're buying 9 megawatts of power on a 20-year contract for our future. And that opportunity came up in the middle of the year where we didn't have time or didn't even know it existed during last year's budget cycle. So consequently, all of the money we're saving on MISO market and the price of power, we're putting back into maintaining this new contract. And we're buying it as a down payment for the future is what it essentially is. So if you take a look at some of our power purchase, you'll see that has gone up on the electric division. And a lot of that has to do with buying part of that power from CMMPA. So starting projects in 2012 that run into 2013, one of the biggest ones is our water plant life extensions. We had 2 water plants in town, and we're looking at the technologies, the techniques to best treat our water relative to the new regulations that are coming up for our water filtering. We want to make sure that the chlorine that we inject at the wells does make it all the way to the end of the line. And there are certain ways of treating that water to make sure that happens, make it more healthy. Our revenues will be adequate to cover expenses plus retained earnings for future capital. Going down into the power plant, this year we're going to be taking our number three boiler and turbine down for overhaul. This year, as every 5 years, we are required to open up the turbine and look inside of it. Oftentimes, you don't know what you're going to see until you open it up. We have $350,000, not $250,000 budgeted for that project, and that will be happening this spring. And once we open it up, we'll find out if everything is good. Then we just have that $350,000 expense to take care of the equipment, clean it up, put it all back together. If we find any major problems like we did a few years ago, the price could go up very quickly. Things get very expensive fast in the power plant. Last time we opened up was the number two turbine generator. That ended up being around $1 million to fix. So that type of thing happens. And if you want to have that equipment ready to run, you have to put that kind of money into that equipment. The rest of the power plant has quite a few different things going on in the maintenance. That's in our operating budget, and we're trying to keep everything as well maintained as possible, so everything will run when we ask for it, and generally that's an emergency or in times of very expensive power. And if it's not running, it could cost us quite a bit very quickly. On the second page here, we've got prepare for cooling tower replacement. The cooling towers on the far end of the away from the power plant have been around for many, many years and are in need of major repair. We have to work through permitting to make sure we can put the money out for this. And so we'll be speaking to our consultants on how to go about the permit process for that. We're also preparing for that power plant upgrade. That's the possible $16 million upgrade that allow us to burn biomass as well as coal. And the permit that we got in March of this year required us, if we were going to do anything on that project, we have to do everything on that project. And that's why we're looking at, and what the big trigger for that would be is whether the price of power on the market continues to go up. Right now it is not, and or the price of natural gas. Because we would be replacing that which we buy on the market with that which we generate ourselves. And right now, that's not economically viable. 3 years ago, it was, when we were going through that process. So we're keeping a very close eye on the market. Now let's move into down the line of all these projects. Are you interested in explanation on each one of these, or can you read those, Dennis? I don't want to waste your time on all of these pieces.
You know, I'd suggest hitting the big ones, the big dollar amounts that you're looking at in 13.
All right. In 2013, we will be designing but not constructing what we're calling the Priam substation. We have had three tornadoes since I've been here that have missed the Willmar substation closely. And one of these days, we figure it's going to dial in, and we have all of our eggs in the one basket. We're trying to separate our liabilities, our exposure, by building a substation miles away from there to fully back up what we have. And we'll take some facilities out of that existing substation and move them down the high voltage line to do that. That's what the transmission substation at $2.3 million. It'll be a couple, 3 years worth of work. You know, next year will be design, and the following years will be construction. We have more power purchase contracts coming up. We're looking towards an expiration of our major power purchase contract in 2016, and it takes this type of time to go through the negotiations to be able to get a good contract that is advantageous for us to replace that. It's a very large single contract. The contract that we purchased this year is roughly one-third, and we're trying to find two other options to replace this contract. And so we'll be discussing that this year and next year with different vendors who may have power to sell. We have underground projects. I'm sure you see our crews for the last 20 years taking overhead lines and bringing them underground. We have 2 years left of, I think it was a 25 to 30 year project And what's happening is that we'll be very happy that all of this is now underground. We are very unusual in distribution systems that we have over 80% of our facilities underground. The Utilities Commission and the city made a conscious decision to do that. Whenever a big wind goes through, we have most everything back up within a couple of days. We were very close to close and watched a lot of that happen in Long Island when we sent our crews out there. Nothing was underground, essentially, and they have trees everywhere. So when that wind came through, everything went down to the ground. And it was a tremendous rebuilding project. So, you know, that's one of the things that's a bit more expensive to do, but we did it over a long period of time, and we're able to say that we got probably one of the more reliable distribution systems out there because of that. However, the first few years that we put in lines, they're getting old, and they will be needing replacing. So as this budget goes away, there'll be another budget item to replace existing lines that are that were put in 30 years ago. The lines are rated at 20-year lifetime, and so they're already gone beyond their estimated life. The newer cables that were installed in early 90s will have a much longer lifetime, so we hope that's well beyond when I retire. We are looking at integrating part of the co-op system into the Willmar utility system, that part that the city annexed down on Abbott Drive. That's in 2014. We're already talking with the county or the Candiota co-op. We have an agreement with them, and that expires, that area expires for them to serve it in 2014. We need to leave their system intact, as well as then bring our system in to take it over. And the part of that will be a distribution substation that will be down at the Willmar sub, as well as distribution lines going to pick up this area and any other development that happens in that Abbott Drive Mills area. And that's coming up in a few years, so we're planning for that in 2013 and 14. So I'm moving through here. The big thing on the water treatment plant, again, is a fairly significant cost a few years down the road. And we need to make a conscious effort on how we want to finance that. We don't want to have a single huge rate increase as a result of some construction like we went through the last couple of years. The 7% times 2 is fairly onerous. We'd like to find out if there's some other way we can finance that as opposed to a single year rate increase, a double digit. So that's coming up. We'll be talking with the commission on that. But those expenses are on the horizon, 2014, 15, 16 for that one. The other big thing we have that we experienced a lot this year is retirements. There's quite a few people in our organization who are getting close to retirement age, and we need to get as much as we possibly can their institutional knowledge before they walk out the door. We were unable to do that this year. That put Larry's replacement and Tim in a position of trying to catch up as fast as they possibly could. Stacy has taken a very good approach to her job. She replaced Larry Heinen as a customer service supervisor. She's doing great. She was able to get up to speed relatively quickly. Tim, in 1 month, has come up to speed amazingly, but he's got a long ways to go to find out how we do things and then move forward from there. I'd rather not be in that position. We'd like to get some people to replace those who are already on staff so we can get that knowledge transferred before they leave. So I'm working on that one. That's about all I have for you right now. Our operating, we go into the operating budgets. We shouldn't see any major things on the operating budgets. This year, our commercial industrial revenues exceeded our budget. Our residential revenues was a bit less. We're projecting a continuation of that trend. We see that some of our commercial and industrial customers are still very strong, and we see some growth on some of the commercial. Hopefully we can see some recovery on the residential. Our expenses, there's nothing that's really comes to mind on operating on a very large amount, except for, again, the power purchase, and we have that. We budgeted that new power purchase contract in our subsequent years. The water and the heating and the general administration are pretty much on from last year. I don't see a large difference on any of those things. We're going to be looking at our labor costs going forward. With all these retirements, the hope is we can replace them with entry level and continue on from there. Any other questions on this?
All right, let's open it up for questions from the council. Do we have questions? Councilmember Ahmed.
On page four, property acquisition of $300,000 is going to be dispersed at, in 3 years, $100,000 each year. Where is that exactly going to be? Is that in the location for the new facility or new offices?
A couple of years ago, we had a study on our facility here, this building, plus our service center. We had an architect do that work. It did a time and motion study and what would be the most, and they came out of that with a recommendation that if we combine all our facilities together with a garage and the office, then we would be much more efficient. We'd have a better run operation. To locate that, we wanted to maintain that we were going to be downtown. And so what this property acquisition is just money available in case any properties to the west of us become available. We're not in a discussion with anybody right now, but it's there in case something like that happens. We were able to pick up the Taco John's property when it came available, but that's where we're at right now.
And the only other, if you could comment briefly on the hot water heating system, district hot water heating system and the revenues that have been taken in there. I know that the long-term indebtedness, I believe that's been paid off as far as do the utilities have any future plans for expanding that, or has there been any reconsideration now with everybody going green? Is that a marketing tool that we need to push out so we can regain some of our lost capital through the years on that expenditure?
Okay, that was a lot of questions. I'll try to...
Yeah, it is.
The first one is the debt has all been retired on the district heating system. I think we're complete with our debts. We've paid that off. We had an extremely warm winter this last year, and so the performance was not that great. Natural gas is the main competitor for the district heating system, and as a result of natural gas prices being so low, it's difficult to compete with the costs that we have on the natural gas, head-to-head with natural gas. As far as marketing the green and the cogeneration portion of it, I have started talking with St. Paul Energy District. They have some people who are very adept at marketing, and we're going to have some meetings with them to see if we can get any common ideas and work from there.
Thank you.
Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Wes. You mentioned in here, or Mr. Ahmed mentioned the property acquisition, and is it the intention to build new somewhere down the road, or... add on to what's here, because you're going to keep it downtown, and I'm suspect in this area with all the property you're going to have.
The plan looked seriously at remodeling what we have, and they found that if we did that, we would not get the space we needed, and would on our cost per square foot would be way higher than if we built new. So the idea, that final idea, was to go build new.
When you get to that point, think about maybe a new city hall connected to it. I mean, we've talked about it before, and it's not a dumb idea. I think it's a good idea to have them both in the same area, use the same auditorium, and whatever. So keep that in the back of your mind, if you would, and thank you again.
As a matter of fact, we have been talking about that, and that is a good idea. Thanks a lot, Ron.
Any other questions?
Wes has shared the report with me, so I can... Wes has shared that report with me. There's their space study with me, and I just haven't had a chance to fully go through it, but that is certainly a possibility worth discussing down the road.
Okay. Councilmember DeBleek.
Yeah, thank you, Councilmember Anderson. Wes, a little bit discussed, meeting earlier, the water plant life extension project, you're looking at it's $6 million over... 2 years, and 15 and 16. And also we've seen a, you've seen like a 2% drop in water sales over the last few years. You think you're going to continue to see that decrease in water sales? And what impact would that have on rates?
Okay. The,
I don't know, that's a lot of questions.
The water sales that actually this year's water sales, because of the dry year, actually have gone up a bit. On an overall long-term trend, if we have a normal moisture year, our water sales will either remain flat or they will track our largest users' water conservation efforts. And as they get better at utilizing their water and conserving it, it will reflect in our sales, but not to such a significant degree that we would delay or eliminate upgrading these plants. The plants were installed 20-some years ago with an estimated life of around 20 years. And they are showing their age, and they need to do. We need to do something to keep them alive. And because of the new regulations that we are required to follow, instead of building a brand new plant at 3 to 4 times this cost, we're looking at taking the existing infrastructure that we have at that place and just putting a new process within it. That's where those costs are coming. As far as the impact on the rates, that is a very large impact on the budget item for the water department. And that's where it could be double digits, up to 15 or more percent increase in a single year, just to help pay for the debt service for that. So it's significant. It's nothing that you ignore. And there are certain ways we could possibly look at preparing for that in our rates before the actual construction.
Yeah, that would be the follow-up on how you're going to look at how we can minimize those impacts if you do indeed see those type of rates.
As a matter of fact, I have been in discussions with Bart about that, because when he told me what impact that could have on the rates, on top of all the other things, you don't want to have that large step. Nobody does. And so what we looked at is a consideration of a different way of looking at our rates, because most of the time rates are paid for those who use the facilities. And if we followed that idea, we would have a double-digit rate increase when we constructed it, as opposed to making some step rate increases prior to that to help fund that. And that would then lessen the impact when the debt was incurred.
Councilmember Dockin.
Thank you. Wes, thank you for being here.
My pleasure.
We had two rate increases, 11 and 12. Do we know what 11, what did we end up with in excess funds in 11, and will we know those numbers in 12? And I know at the commission meeting today, we talked about that, or you talked about that, and the fact that you're seeing also a lot of conservation happening. And so can you talk about the relationships of those two, the fact that there has been some savings because of conservation, and what do we have over and above the cost of operation for 11 from that 7% in 11, right, and 7% in 12, right?
That's correct.
And 11, we started, what, in June or July?
July 1st.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a 7%. This is electric you were talking, correct?
Right.
They had 7% in July of 2011 and then 7% in January of 2012. Our retained earnings in 2011 looked like we had about $600,000. That's what we show on the budget here. Our projected retained earnings are budgeted for this year is about $1 million. Right now, the way our operating budget looks, it could be exceeding that. But again, we have this CMMPA contract, this new power contract that is taking a lot of that unbudgeted money. So as far as operations go, we might, I'd be glad to get at budgeted by the end of this year. As far as the conservation, we're not really exactly sure what the cause of having 2% less sales in kilowatt hour from last year to this year is. We have had more activity, like I said, in the commercial industrial, but less in the residential. And it could be conservation. It could be just less houses being connected. I don't really have that answer right now, or they might be using less because the rates in or provide an incentive to be more conservative.
I basically think it could be some uncertainty in the economy starting as far back as 2008. Your comment about what percent of the city is not doesn't have buried power lines, and I didn't realize that they only lasted for, you said, 20 years, and then you have to start to redo them again or patch them? Or
yes, we are at over 80% of the city is underground, and this is the distribution areas. You see the power lines on the main roads. We intend to keep those overhead. The reason we do that is because fixing an outage off of those, when you just concentrate on your main feeders, you can do your tree trimming correctly and keep up with it well, as well as there are so many taps off of that particular line that it would be very, very expensive to replace that. And you'd have to do it in a duct system, which is 2 to 3 times more than what we're doing with the backyards and in the residential. What we're burying is the stuff that actually serves the houses.
Residential,
yeah. Mainly. All new commercial is underground. All new, everything is underground, but our main feeders continue to be overhead, and I'd advocate they stay that way. It doesn't take long to fix them, and we know exactly where that problem is. If you've ever had an outage in the middle of winter, you understand if you're underground, it takes a while to find that. Our linemen have to go out there with shovels first to find the pad-mounted switchgear, dig it out, and then find out if that's the problem inside of there. And they do that over and over and over until they can find that. So as you're inside nice and warm, they're out there digging in the snow. So it takes a while to get those outages repaired. If it's overhead, you see it right away. That's the main advantage of that.
Yeah, I guess I could have asked the question better. What percentage of residential still is above ground, would you say?
This would be a wild estimate, but not more than 10%.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Councilmember Fagerty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Wes, for being here. Your portable transformer, mobile one, was that the unit that was in the parking lot this summer here, or is that the diesel one south and southwest of town?
The mobile substation is the one that was in our parking lot earlier this year.
Okay.
And we had to use that as a backup, what it was intended to be, to the transformer that's operating right now. We had to shut that down. We didn't have enough capacity on the rest of the system to back that particular one up. So that's a mobile substation. When we did energize it, it did what it needed to, and we do a predictive oil testing on everything. These things are filled with oil, and if you test the oil, you discover what's going on inside of there. And we, as a result of that predictive oil test, we discovered that this needs some major attention to keep it as a viable backup for any of our substations. A brand new unit would cost about $1.5 million. So we feel this is a good investment of our funds for that particular thing.
And we have a couple of units that have diesel engines on, don't we?
We have 6 diesel generators at 2 sites, the southwest and the east substation, and they're all hooked up right now. They're not mobile, even though they are on wheels. Everything's hooked up as a permanent connection.
And you just purchased them?
We just purchased those in October. That's correct.
You rented them before?
We were leasing them from 2000 until 2012.
Okay. You don't need to do anything on them then right now?
Our plans for next year, as shown on power plant, our power production department 2 and 3, we'll take them off the wheels and put them on a slab of concrete, make it a bit more permanent, give them a bit more room between them. They need they operate better with more air, but that's the main plan for that.
All right, thanks.
Any other questions? Councilmember Ahman.
I always have two.
Yeah.
it's a great opportunity to be here, and we don't maybe talk about it candidly, but after reading and everything in the news about certain communities and areas of our country that are short on water, You know, does a, has a hydrologist or somebody ever done a thorough study of, you know, what's the strength of our aquifers as far as capacity and as far as we plan for the city? I know that's an ongoing question as deal on an annual basis, but as a long term, what is the condition of our aquifers, and is there a concern, a shortage of water in the future? Is this a great marketing idea we have? If we have an abundant amount of water, and that's very positive for Jenny O, who's the largest consumer. But, you know, to what point are we going to be, or will we ever be questioning the water capacity of our aquifers?
Well, I'm not a water expert, Steve, but I have talked to Bart in various times asking that similar question of, do we have adequate water? And yes, we do. We have lots of water at the aquifers that we're at. They are not anywhere near capacity or even in danger of being overtapped, my understanding. So that question, as far as utilizing our abundance of water as a marketing tool, that I hadn't considered that, but that might be something we could take a look at.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we got it. Thank you. Very well done.
Thank
and
you for your
we
time.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
Thanks. Okay, folks. Now we're going to get into the meat and potatoes of this, and our work begins, and that's going to be to deal with the budget. Before we get into that, I'm going to ask the mayor if he has any comments or remarks to make, and then we'll move forward from there.
I do have a couple of comments to make. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to say that now is the time for all the council people to make any changes necessary or that they look at, that they see that they want to change or whatever. We're running short of time. What is the time that we have to, the date?
The plan will be that the budget will have a resolution to adopt the budget tonight that will go to the council meeting on December 3rd, which is next week. So you're right, the time is short. Now, if we can't get it done by then, we have an alternate. We can go as late as the 17th of December, but I'm hoping that by the time we're done tonight, we've got a pretty good handle on where we are.
And something that we can send to the council, the full council, on Monday night.
On Monday night. Yes.
Thank you. That's really all I have is the encouragement to do something with the budget if now is the time to do it, if you think of it or if you see things that need to be added or subtracted, let's do it now. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. That's a good point. I think what we're going to do, we've got a little PowerPoint that Steve and Charlene are going to go through. If you have questions, let's deal with them right at the right when they're up there and while we're talking about it rather than try to hold them. And then we can have general discussion at the end. The only thing that I'd like to ask is, I don't want to spend an inordinate amount of time dealing with a $500 item. I mean, we can talk about it, decide, and move on. We've got some bigger things, I think, to talk about. So, but bring it up if it's bothering you, and we'll resolve it, but we don't want to belabor the point. So, with that, we'll turn it over to Charlene and Steve.
Our copy's in front, and we're going to try to pull this up here and see if this works. It's been asleep for a while, and see if I can. Okay. Just a reminder of, you know, the city's mission statement and the goals that we use when we're trying to develop the budget, and these are the goals that were a part of a city council workshop in early 2011. A reminder of where we are. We do have a rather strong financial picture that our revenues are stable. We do have a AA bond rating. We're still seeing growth in new construction. We're able to maintain basic services, and one of our goals in the 2013 budget was building a capital improvements program. This will show you kind of where we started the mayor's proposed budget and where the revisions are or recommended revisions are. Back in August, when we started and presented the budget, we had a general operating budget of about $15,090,000, a capital improvements of $5,051,000, special revenue internal funds $919,636. Our debt service was approximately $2.4 million, and then our enterprise fund, which is our wastewater fund, was $8.2 million, and the total for all the funds was $31,725,416. And again, a reminder was the general operating fund included a $1.8 million transfer for capital improvements, and this was purposeful, and this was part of our trying to develop a five-year capital plan and be able to fund that. The revisions show that we have a general operating fund now that we are recommending at $15.2 million. The capital improvements remain the same. The special revenue internal decreased to $731,000, and then the debt service and the enterprise fund remain the same. That change from the general operating and the special revenue fund is based upon the action you took to consolidate the RAC 8 funding within the general operating fund. So we reduced our special revenue funds, and then we increased our general operating fund. And you'll see it again in, and it shows you where, we're showing you too, where we made those changes in the general fund. You see the property taxes and the franchise fee increasing from the proposed budget to the revised. That is also, that is due to RAC 8. That includes those revenues in there. The other change that you will see is interest earnings and reimbursement. That's also a change with based on RAC 8 and based on those interest earnings. And the fund balance change that decreased there is also due to the changes with RAC 8. You'll see over, and then over in expenses, and I'll walk through these a little more closely after this, but the big increase in administration from $543,000 to $698,000 is attributable to RAC 8 because the administration includes the IT budget, and we are bringing the expenditures of RAC 8 into the IT budget. And that is the change there. Mayor and Council, there is a reduction. That was action that the Council took on that budget. Public safety, there was a change. The change there is based upon our contract wage settlements. And so I can kind of walk you through this a little more.
What about non-departmental?
Non-departmental. Let me see. That change.
The community partners.
Was that change? That was changed based on our community partners?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, and the community partners changed at 125 to 115. That was based on some changes the council made with the baseball boosters and the historical society to take those out of the 2013 budget and pay those out of the 2012 budget. And Steve, the changes in non-departmental, the increase there?
I have to look at that. The non-departmental, as it was listed in the previous amount, it only included the governmental non-departmental, did not include public safety and the other non-departmental categories. So those were down in the other categories.
The other, of public works. Okay. So that was that was the change there, and that's the public works there. Okay. So just to kind of summarize the net revenue changes, we're showing an additional. There was an addition there. The net revenue changes are about $240,000 in revenue changes. The net reallocation of the RAC 8 brought in an additional $165,000 in revenue to the general fund. There is an increase from the municipal utilities intergovernmental transfer that is based upon. I'm sorry for the typo on that. That is based upon the recently negotiated agreement. We had budgeted an increase based on the prior agreement. This additional $40,000 is based upon the change of going from 4.8% to 4.9%. And then there was an error that we did not include revenue for the building services contract that we have in place with Candiota County. So when that budget was proposed in August, that $15,000 of revenue was just left out. The changes in expenditures, the net effect of those is $177,966, almost $178,000. Mayor and council salaries, that was a reduction, $13,000. Bringing the RAC 8 reallocation in, that adds to our expenditures, $154,000. The police department wage settlement, that was an addition in expenditures. The fire chief was hired at a lower salary, so that was a savings to us. Library funding, that was a savings that was reduced by $5,000. The Historical Society, that $1,000 was taken out of there based upon the recommendation that the city that was made at the last city council meeting to fund them out of the 2012 budget. And then a proposal that will be discussed at the Public Works Public Safety regarding the airport management. If that proposal is adopted, that would increase our transfer over to airport management in of approximately $42,000. And I recognize that the Public Works Public Safety Committee has not taken that action, but I guess I would say that it's prudent to potentially include that pending the action. So that's why I bring it forward. So the net effect of the changes of $220,000 in revenue, expenses of $178,000, left us with a surplus of $42,769. We did have a previous balance of $55,292 that we had not allocated. It gives us a net available revenue or surplus for the 2013 budget of just over $98,000.
Can we stop? I want to make sure everybody's went through that kind of fast.
Sorry.
No, that's fine. It wasn't you, but we've got $98,000. That more revenue than expenses because of the changes that we've made, plus the fact that when the budget was originally submitted, there was $55,000 of additional revenue with no expenses against it. So that brings us to the $98,000, and that's a number that we're going to come back to at some point in time and talk about. And then, okay, go ahead, and unless there's questions on that. Okay.
I think the just want to present to you what I think are the options for that available balance is that the 2013 budget does include an increased levy of $240,000. That increased levy was to be dedicated. It is to be dedicated to infrastructure. One option of that available balance would be to reduce the proposed levy by that $98,000 and only levy the remainder, and that would still allow us to do the additional infrastructure work and street work that was proposed. Another option is to increase the transfer to capital reserve. We're currently budgeting about $1.8 million. We could increase that transfer over and then hold it in reserve for future projects and continue to build that reserve. You also could restore funding that was previously cut from the budget. And this is a reminder of where we are with the levy for 2013. The general operating levy was proposed at $3.9 million, almost $4 million. The street program, it was $240,000. And so that would give us an increased levy that was proposed at $240,000. And then just to remind folks where what the effect of that levy increase was, we estimated what the effect of that levy increase was based upon an average home of $115,000. The impact is about $25.47 a year, or about $2.12 per month, and that's the impact of the $240,000 levy. And with that, happy to answer any questions or regarding this or any of the other items in the budget.
Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The levy increase of $240 for street and infrastructure. Is that permanent going forward then? We're going to do that every year?
Well, annually you have to levy.
That's what the idea is?
I think that was the mayor's intent.
That is the mayor's intent that would go forward. And as I understand it, is that the levy would be, in future years, be put towards infrastructure. So that could be buildings, it could be roads, it could be roads for 5 years, it could be
The levy was not proposed for general operating and not budgeted for general operating. It was budgeted for infrastructure, so it would be used in 2013. The proposal was to use that for increased overlay of streets.
That was my. I thought the intention was strictly for streets. I mean, because we're falling behind. I mean, we are constantly, but
that would be up to the council, councilman.
Okay, and again, I raised the question in the last meeting we had. Why not take it up on unspent funds instead of putting it all into the capital improvement program that you had suggested? Why wouldn't we do that? Tell me the reasons why we wouldn't do that instead.
Well, I think you certainly could with the available balance. You could reduce it by $98,000. Going, and you can on a one-time basis take it out of capital reserve. It's just that it's non-renewing. So to do that every year, to take $240,000 out of capital and move that into just streets, is going to take that away from other capital projects, which do include our building, include technology, includes parks and maintenance. And where we are falling behind on streets, we are also falling behind on our overall infrastructure and capital maintenance. And so I think that's just the balance that we would have to do each year, but it's not renewing, and at some point that's going to catch up with us.
Mm-hmm. Can I comment on that a little bit too? Because I too thought that we should look at, and I had proposed maybe taking half of it out of reserves. We do have the $98,000 that we could apply towards that. I guess one of the other things that concerns me a little bit is if we take it out of our savings account, so to speak, we're not sure what's going to happen to local government aid moving forward, and you know that could have a significant impact on us. So maybe this isn't the time to take money out of our reserve account, but I think that's a decision that we definitely have to make. It's not necessarily bad, and it's not necessarily wrong. It's just how does the council feel about that?
Well, to my knowledge, we haven't taken money out of the reserve account for, when was the last time? I mean, it's like a rainy day fund. I mean, and it's raining. I mean, it's not raining, but our roads are in disrepair, and the levy increase isn't a whole lot, you know, per parcel in town, but it does affect a lot of people that are on fixed incomes, and we're looking at a rate study for sewer and water, knowing that it's probably going to go up. So we need to be thinking about our taxpayers when we're proposing any kind of a levy increase. I would suggest taking the $98,000 and then taking 98 out of the 240.
Yep.
I think that would be a prudent good use of that money. In fact, I'd like to take it all out of reserve and then maybe do the levy next year. We don't know what the future holds. I don't know what 2013 is going to do for my business or anybody else's, but I'm always concerned about the taxpayer, no matter how small they are. So I would suggest taking that 98. That would be my suggestion and applying it toward that 240. I mean, it was your idea, Dennis, and I think that's good.
I'd like to hear from other council members on that, because this is a big deal. This is one of the bigger things that we're going to have to decide tonight. Councilmember Dockin.
Thank you, Dennis. Charlene, you started by saying that revenues are stable. I'm wondering, in light of the LGA, how can revenues...
They are stable for 2013, in that we have been given the same allocation as we were for 2012, that they were frozen. But it is correct. We do not know what is going forward in terms of local government aid. This 2012-2013... the governor's had a task force, the legislature has had a group studying local government aid and the formula, and you know that formula could change. There is to be a new funding formula, or there are discussions on that, and we don't know what that formula could look like or how it could impact our community yet. So
okay.
Councilmember Ahman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I think you all understand where I feel about the infrastructure of our streets, deteriorated streets, and I've made that clear. And I understand the proposal of $98,000, and I agree with that 100%. My other concern is when you're looking at, and I've brought this up before too, is the long term condition of our roads, and with it deteriorating, we're never able to catch up. We're only going to be able to in a small portion, and I still believe that with the cost of the inflation factors coming up into play that have been in play this year, that we are going to be even falling shorter. And this is only a very small step to maintain what we have, but not really deal with the ongoing problem facing us, and that we have miles and miles and miles each year that need a lot more maintenance. And again, the maintenance should be part of the overall budget to keep those streets in a condition that's not to the point where it's deteriorated so badly that we have to replace the whole road. I think we could extend the life of those roads. So if if 98,000 is satisfactory to you, it's satisfactory to me. I just wish it could be somehow increased.
Councilmember Almond, I would also remind the council, we did allocate an additional, I believe it was 60,000 towards crack seal and maintenance as part of the street program as well.
Yeah, and I stopped by the engineer's office and looked at what those proposals, they were working on the drawings of what street it's going to be, and it's like a dot on a large map. It does not even begin to look at the overall picture of our streets. And I just want to say again, we're falling behind. We're going to have to deal with it. I'm not sure how. Right now, maybe not this year, but I agree with the $98,000 being put into the capital improvement fund, and that will be very helpful to us.
Now, wait a minute. I want to be. Maybe I didn't understand what you just said, but what I think the suggestion was that we've got the 240,
right,
and the suggestion is not to increase the 240 by 98, but to reduce the levy by that 98. Okay, that's what. Okay, I just wanted to be
but
clear.
But still do the $240,000.
Still do $240,000
worth of work.
Additional work. I mean, we've already got work in the budget.
We already have $2.5 million in the street program.
Mm-hmm.
We already have $2.5 million in the street program that will deal with reconstruction and overlay. And this would allow us to do some additional overlay, I think, is what we proposed to you.
Easy for you to say. Councilmember Reese.
Thank you. You know, we've made some great strides in spite of it all as far as our maintenance of our streets. We really have. I mean, I probably should have said before that, I am concerned. I mean, I brought to the Public Works Safety Committee about 2 years ago the idea of bonding to be able to do more work. And we didn't go any place with that because we are falling behind, like Councilmember Christensen said. And we've been falling behind as long as I can remember. The strides that I'm talking about is we used to do seal coating. We did not do any crack sealing. Seal coating maintains the drivable surface of the street, but crack sealing maintains the substructure of the street. And having a crack sealing has been, a crack sealing program has been a tremendous asset for our infrastructure. When it comes to the $98,000, I don't know, can anybody tell me if I'm fine with taking the 98,000 and reducing the 250? But what if we added that 98,000 to the 250? What would that do?
I need Bruce to assist me with this. When we looked at the 240,000, I think we were challenged a little bit to find the right number of streets that met the overlay requirement, and that also the municipal utilities could, if there was necessary, do waterline replacement on. And so I'm not sure if we put another 98,000 to overlay, if we could do streets. We may be able to do some parking lots, and that's a need with that. I mean, I think we're trying to manage that 240,000 with the capacity of staff we have and also the ability and the rating system that we have in doing that. And the reason we went to overlay versus reconstruct is if you were to try to do some additional reconstruct, we would have to dedicate that $240,000 for a 20-year period to the bonding and only get about a mile more of reconstruct. So it wasn't enough kind of bang for the dollar, if you will, to do it that way. And so the $240,000, and I think we've worked hard, and I think we can do the $240,000 worth of additional overlay and feel comfortable with that. I'm not sure about the $98,000. I mean, we could do some work to look at that and how we would use that, but there was a little bit of a challenge with the $240,000 in finding the right mix of streets that needed to be done that met the requirement, and then that also kind of fit with the municipal utilities and their water line and replacement program as well. So it's so it works. It's just you got to put the both puzzles to both kind of both all the puzzle pieces together. So if you were going to use the $98,000, I think at this point, I'd recommend that maybe we do some parking lots or another area of infrastructure where we're falling behind. We have some downtown parking lots that are slated, I think, in the capital program for 2014, and maybe those could be accelerated if you didn't want to reduce the levy with that $98,000.
Well, rebuilding a parking lot is going to be expensive also, so I think it's food for thought. You know, I know we got to make a decision here tonight. So
that's why we're here. I mean, to hear all sides of this. I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor.
It's okay. I think the $98,000, I think, should be explained that that's not a set figure. In other words, further cuts could make that $98,000 whatever, $150,000. Keep that in the back of your mind. So that $98,000 isn't necessarily the figure that we have to work off of. Did I say that properly?
Yeah, that's true. It's subject to whatever else we do, the 98 will go up or down. But, I mean, philosophically, what do we want to do with the 98?
And we certainly, to make this easier, could also talk in round numbers. I mean, 100,000, we can adjust an interest projection or something if you want to just make it an easier number to work with of a 100,000 and levy 140,000. I mean, mm-hmm. Either way, we can do that.
Yep.
It's a nice problem to have.
I would like to, if I may, just point out another thing in the interest of transparency. I've noticed that the city of Willmar, nowhere in the proposed budget does it say mayor's proposed budget, so I mean, I'd certainly be willing, as a matter of fact, I'd love it if we called it the city administrator's proposed budget or something else other than the mayor's proposed budget. I noticed that the mayor's name was taken off of the proposed budget from the last proposed budget. So
that's simply an oversight. It was a rush to get it done. I'm sorry about that.
No problem.
You know, I think the charter calls for the mayor to propose or to cause to be proposed the budget. So that, yeah, it is your budget and should have been on there.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. It was a short holiday week and we were putting this together late this afternoon, so I apologize for that.
I want to try to have a dialogue and a discussion on these things, but are there any other items? I have one, but I'm wondering if there are other related items that should be talked about. Councilman Blake.
Thank you, Councilman Anderson. I think we need to go back and look at some of our community requests we've had, go over that list. I know two in particular is the West Central Integration Collaborative. You know, we cut their funding in half from what they were getting. You know, they support culture diversity in the community, and our community is not getting less culturally diverse, it's getting more. I think we need to look at supporting those that are not cutting their budget. I think we need to look at higher support there. The other one is the Willmar Design Center. They do a lot of support in the downtown. Our central business district support. They're doing a lot of things that our city staff don't have to do. They're picking up and doing. And flowers, for one, we asked. They're taking over the downtown flowers. We're not supporting them at the level they requested, but just a couple observations. I think we need to look at those two items in particular.
Okay, and that you hit on one of them that I wanted to talk about a little bit, and that's the design center. And I know that we have some folks here that if we get stumped, they'll be more than happy to help us out. But if I'm remembering correctly, we funded the design center at $25,000 in 2012. They had a request of 43 for 13.
43,400 was mm-hmm. their request,
and we funded
32,000.
Okay, now the question in my mind is, what's not going to happen if we don't fund it to the 42? And what portion of that is flowers? And I'm wondering if I could call on John and or Bev. John, would you come up and kind of fill us in on at least my confusion here?
Thank you, Chairman Anderson. I'm John Christensen. I am treasurer of the Willmar Design Center. And I realize you have a lot of big decisions this evening, and we appreciate the time. In front of you, what was handed out is something that probably looks familiar, and it was the progress report in terms of talking about the design center. That was at the last meeting we were here. And the second page, which really was the operating budget, and hopefully will answer the questions that Chairman Anderson had related to the budget. And again, the purpose of the Design Center is to partner, to be a partner with city organizations, city government, and to help renew the center of the city. One is there's been significant activities, the number of people, the 9,000 to 10,000 people downtown, 4,000 to 5,000 volunteer hours related to the Design Center, and over $340,000 in grants. And I just bring that up associated with some of the activities, and those are not all just Willmar Design Center, they're all in partnership with staff, in partnership with other organizations associated with it. And to your question, Chairman Anderson, $43,400 was requested. The second the column next to it that's actually in green on the budget is what would be requested, assuming that the downtown flowers, that the Design Center is not responsible for the downtown flowers. And the $7,500 budget item was part of the request associated with the downtown flowers and maintaining those downtown flowers with volunteer help. If that's not part of it, obviously the budget request would get lowered by the $7,500, which would be the $35,900. And the Design Center is happy, I guess, with either direction. If the responsibility for the flowers you'd like us, the Design Center, to take on, that's fine. If it is not, and that can be handled through the city contracting, that is absolutely fine as well. We're looking at, you know, that's one of the things that just help short-term projects that help the downtown city. The goal is really economic development, long-term partnering objectives for downtown, the city of downtown. So we are, I guess, the $35,900 is what the Design Center would respectfully request as a budget allocation. The other two columns reflect some of the cuts that would need to be made in the city budget or the budget of the Design Center if the budget gets further cut, and those essentially get down to grant writer fees get reduced, and so we would have a difficulty in terms of looking at and applying for some of the additional grants and some of the additional incentives that we've had in the past for downtown Willmar.
Okay. Yeah. This answers my questions, I think. Now we need to talk about this because we, in the mayor's budget, we have $32,000.
The mayor had included $32,000.
So we can,
if I may,
sure.
With the inclusion that they do the flowers, is that what I'm hearing? You're opposed to doing the flowers at the $32,000?
Yeah. That would be, I guess, there would not be funds as far as providing the flowers at $32,000 budget. If you look at it, but I guess that would not be in the budget associated with the, it was a $32,000.
Does that
Well, you know, when I made out the budget, I was assuming that the $32,000 would include the flowers, the $7,000 for the flowers. And if it does not, then I think we should go back to $25,000 in the budget.
Okay, and
we have someone else, as I understand, that may be interested in doing the flowers and the watering and so forth?
There's a proposal that the city administrator has. So, and what you're suggesting is the final column, the 2013 budget at $25,000, you can see what they could do.
Yes, and the reason why I say that is because the city also pays for the Willmar Fest, pays dearly for the Willmar Fest, as I understand it. Plus, the city of Willmar also pays a portion, or will pay a portion, of the entrances and the exits for the new portion of the development of the downtown area. So I don't see any reason personally to do the more than the $25,000 in the budget, which is open for discussion.
That's what I'd like to hear from the council. Council Member Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. I don't know how far back we go when we started, you know, helping fund the Downtown Design Center, but what was the intent? What was the intent when we first started to give the money? Was it to do it forever annually, or what was the council's intent? I don't recall when we started it. Maybe Bev or John might. You know, we just have it going back 3-4 years or back to 2010. But what was our intent at the time? Was it just to help them out for a few years, get them going, or was it to every year fund this with maybe some appreciation or I'm at a loss for words here, but what was our intent? What was it when we started this?
And I have an opinion, but I'll John or Bev, if either of you have a comment, and then we'll come back here.
I can make a comment about that. And as far as the design center, the purpose I look at was having a private downtown owners organization to help renew the center of the city, help to do some of the things that it's difficult for city government to do. Help to look at it from a separate perspective of the city, from a city government perspective. When we look at things, you know, I view the budget we're talking about. I view this budget as really the city's budget. We can call it the design center budget. We're just trying to help and facilitate things within the city of Willmar. When we looked at, you know, in the design center budget in some of the years past, I think it was $50,000 in 1 year. But a big portion of that budget was purchasing furniture for downtown streets. You know, and that's great, and that's fine. But I look at, you know, that's city infrastructure, so to speak, and that's the purpose. I mean, it's the purpose to work with the city, and how do we help move the objectives of the city jointly together? Design Center is not going to do it alone. And to the extent that the Design Center can aid the city, city council, city staff, that's the purpose. Over here.
I'm thinking that when we did it, it was, I don't know if we had a long-range vision. I think it was to try to get this concept going, and it's just kind of evolved. But one of the things that I want to remember, too, is we've gotten an incredible return on the money that we've invested. There have been grants submitted, and I know Bev has told us numerous times, it's thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars of grant money that's come to the city that's helped beautify and make some changes downtown. So, other comments? Nobody? Councilmember Dockin.
You started by saying, Dennis, that go back and look at other community requests. What are some of the other community requests that we're not talking about?
Well, the West Central Integration Collaborative is one, and I would need some help.
I can review the request that we had and funded, and did we discuss these, I think, in a September meeting, is that the Going Green Day has been funded at the $6,000 level. Councilmember DeBleek referenced the West Central Integration Collaborative, and that was a request for $42,000, and they've been funded at $21,000. We're in the third or fourth year of an ongoing commitment to the Humane Society for $10,000 a year as part of their building that was done. And so that has been funded. Willmar Fest is funded at $25,000. And then West Central Industries was $15,000, and that's for Meals on Wheels. And that's what they were funded at their requested level. The baseball boosters have been removed from the budget because those will be paid out of the 2012 budget, and the Candy, Ohio Historical Society has also been removed from the budget because that was to pay that out of the 2012. And then we also include a $1,000 contribution to the Leadership Perspectives Program, and then we did include a $1,500 request to the Community Marketing Coalition, and that is probably, quite honestly, most appropriately funded out of dues and subscriptions because it's a dues-based, it's to have a seat at the table at the Community Marketing Coalition, we would need to pay that $1,500 in dues. And that was something the city had been a member of back in 2009 was the last year the city was a member of the Community Marketing Coalition. But those are the funding requests, and I believe Councilmember DeBleek was just referencing the two that were not funded at their requested levels. But I'm not sure if that's accurate, Councilmember.
Well, in reference to the West Central Integration Collaborative, we did fund them at $42,000 in 2012.
Correct. That was their level, and they requested, I believe they requested $42,000, and they were funded at $21,000.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask you, Councilman, can I ask you, Councilman, what does the collaboration do? Do you know?
I know they do a lot with minority business, restarting, getting minority businesses starting, fostered in the downtown area and in the community. They support a lot of the cultural work with the minority community as far as integrating them into the community. So there is a high number of things that they do, and I think it's we are a cultural diverse community, and that's not going to change.
Thank you. If I may, could we finish up with the design center?
Yeah, I think I was ready to comment here. Yeah. Did you have a comment?
I want to go back to our intent initially, and because I don't recall when it was, but are we to continue to fund them year after year after year? Is that what the council's purpose is here, or are they going to get revenue from another source for their expenses for the coming years? I mean, I see ours, what we've given to them in the past 4 years, but where does the rest of the revenue come from for your budget? I think we have it here.
Yeah, thank you. I will give you the total budget related to it. Before, we've been requested to submit a separate city budget. At the $35,900, as an example, that would represent about 40% of the expenditures of the design center. The balance would come from stakeholders, which is private business downtown, would come from other fundraising, which is revenue from the Becker Market, revenue from the Becker Cafe, other fundraising sources that they've had associated with the, as an example, the Holidays Parade is a self-sustaining funded event where there's stakeholders and sales, so to speak, that cover the costs associated with the holidays parade. Same thing with Becker Market is actually a revenue generator. So the But the city portion represents about 40% of the total budget.
So then can I safely assume that the city is the only funding that's coming from a governmental institution for your revenue? I mean, you don't get money from the hospital or MUC or other.
That's correct.
Governmental.
That's correct. That'd be correct. The other would be private businesses, mm-hmm. sales, another organization, grants. You know, there's over $300,000 of grants in the last couple of years that have been received. Part of the, you know, that's part of the grant writing effort and looking at opportunities and leveraging the funding from the city.
So I'm looking at your proposed budget here for 13 and this 72.3. Is that?
Yes.
That's correct.
That's correct.
Okay. Well, now I have a little better handle on what's going on, but I still don't know what our intent was, if we're just going to keep giving money year after year after year. Some of it's going to maybe depend on our LGA, what happens there, or.
I think maybe the fairest thing to do would be to try to figure out what our intent is going forward. You know, if our intent is to get out, we should let them know that, you know, that we're looking at decreasing funding over a five-year period or whatever it might be. But we're on this subject. What do we want to do? We're at 25. Or I'm sorry, we're at 32 in the budget, does not include flowers. And I think that's the sum and substance of it.
If I may, Mr. Chair, if we do say fund them 35.9 like they've got under this green highlighted bar there, the excess money is above 32 would be coming from that $98,000, correct?
That's correct. Okay. Potentially, yeah. I mean, that's the pot that we have to deal with.
Right, okay.
Yeah, at this point, the $3,900 difference would have to come from that.
Yes, Councilmember Fager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The way I look at it, it's hiring an independent contractor to market the downtown. If we hired a city staff person, I think we'd be paying more than $35,900. So I think we're getting a good deal having them do it.
Okay. I think, to me, the question is, if we're going to fund them at whatever level it is it going to include flowers? Flowers have become a really big deal, and they're important, I think. They're darned important that the flowers are downtown, but do we expect them to do flowers, or do we hire an outside contractor? Or do they hire an outside contractor? Or where do we do? Where do we want to go?
What's the proposal for flowers?
There is a proposal that the city received for approximately $6,200 to do the flower baskets, and that would be to install them roughly Mother's Day and until the first hard frost, and then they would be taken down after the first hard frost. So, you know, roughly Mother's Day to end of October, I guess, I think would be. And they would be installed, and they would be watered for that. It's a very reasonable proposal. I mean, it is.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chair, I just to reiterate your point and question about flowers, that's the reason that Design Center initiated and pushed to volunteer to raise money for the flowers initially was the thought they were important. But if there's another way of getting the flowers and doing that is absolutely fine with the Divine Center, the Design Center. And so in the event that if they're not going to be done, the Design Center would look at a way of getting them done. You know, that's. But either way is fine.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, Mr. Amon. Yes.
Thank you. You know, when we look at the, we just completed the comprehensive plan with the community and the downtown, showing the direction we want to go and the priorities and who are the people are going to be that are going to be the team going forward to facilitate accomplishing all those goals. We are one of the major players. The Design Center is one of the major players. And if we don't have that group, what have we just done? We've gone backwards. And I understand Mr. Christensen's viewpoint as far as the funding, and you can use this philosophy on everything that we're going to be talking about here on non-departmental funds is, we'll fund you now, but what's your plan on defunding? We assume it's always going to be in the budget. And I guess that's a big question, and it's a good point. We should always be looking at you know, pinching dollars, whether it be $500 or $1,500 or $25,000 or whatever. But, you know, I believe in this case, it warrants the money that's in the budget. And if we can meet their goal, I think for now, that's something we have to work on maybe to decrease it. But for now, with all the irons in the fire with downtown, I think this is a good investment, in long and short. That's my personal opinion on it right now. And if we can save a little money by having a different company for $6,200 do the flowers and subcontract with them, as I think it's going to be cheaper to do it there or less expensive to do it that way than to have the design center do it, that's more operating capital to accomplish the goals of the design center. We've been talking about this for 4 years in the design center. I've sat on the board. There's aggressive, very hardworking people that are trying to move forward. And I know it's hard to do that without capital, but if we decrease the amount of revenue that we're going to give them by a substantial amount, it's going to cripple the effects of the long-term goals we're trying to accomplish. So we're going backwards. So I agree with the concept of maybe scaling things back, but let's also move forward with the goals and keep working on the plan. Otherwise, we've spent a considerable amount of staff time and our time, and we're not going to move forward with it. So,
yeah.
Committed to the idea of moving forward with that.
So just so I'm clear in my mind, if the city picked up the flowers, what level would you think? I mean, you're our representative on there. So what level do you think then that they should be funded at?
Well, I believe you can round the numbers down to $35,000. If we can come up with that revenue somehow, I think that would be fine.
And then the city pays for the flowers?
And the city pays for the flowers. And I think next year we're going to have to work harder on it and keep working on it. And I think the key thing here is once we get the downtown improvements done, the gateway to the downtown, that's our number one priority from what I can see. Flowers are something that's going to benefit everybody. It's going to beautify the downtown. I think that's an investment.
Councilmember Christensen, you...
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, we haven't seen the financial statements of the Downtown Design Center, but I hold in my hand the chambers, and I see at the end of the year they had cash of $88,320. The beginning of the year they had $85,955. So they increased their cash at the end of the year by a few thousand dollars. Why don't we take that $1,000 for leadership perspectives and give it to the Design Center?
And fund them at what level to do what?
I'm fine with $35,900.
Then that includes the flowers or does not include the flowers?
I got to think about that because the mayor and his proposal was 25 and they added 7.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, that's what we've got to come up with here.
But my suggestion is this $1,000 from leadership perspectives. I mean, they have the money on hand. They're not short.
Okay.
That would be one place to get $1,000.
Mr. Chair, can I add something to Councilman Ammon's suggestion? Would you be opposed to a situation as to where we fund them the $35,000 this year, but then say in 2014 we start cutting the $25,000 back? Would you be open to that?
I think we'll have to deal with that next year, but I agree with the concept. I think the Design Center knows inevitably that as things progress that revenue will be cut from their budget eventually. Unless they come up with some real hard prospectus on what they plan on doing, we need the revenue for it. I understand that philosophy. I'll agree to that philosophy, but right now we're dealing with 2013 budget. I strongly agree.
Are you open to that, Mr. Christensen?
Well, I would look at it, the Design Center. Right now everything is set to focus on the city long-term plan and the city comprehensive plan that's been put forth and one the Design Center is looking at being part of that and wanting to help participate with that. As an example, the gateways that have been talked about the design center is providing the funding for the design of the gateways. And so we look at it and we talk about your budget, my budget. I'm really kind of indifferent as to whose budget that is, because they all are part of the city, what the city needs to get done. And so, you know, if you take some of these items out and put it in the city budget, the thing, the objective still gets met. And so I guess I'm, you know, matter, we can certainly look at that in 2014 if that's the goal in terms of how we're looking at meeting the comprehensive plan.
That was a pretty good tap dance.
And I just want to be clear for that Mr. Christensen is correct. I mean, the design, the gateway design is being, that funding is, the city's funds are being matched by the design center to pay for those. So the city has allocated funds for the design of the gateways, and that funding has also been matched by the design center. So that has offset the city's cost. And that's just information just to be clear on it. That is accurate.
One of the opportunities that the design center can provide is the design center can do some things that city staff potentially can't. One is leveraging city funds, looking at other grants, and looking at the opportunity of grants and incentives that are out there. And you can say, well, you can have a philosophical difference on should we be getting those incentives or grants. Now, I'm comfortable doing that. I'm pretty conservative in nature. I'm comfortable in looking at getting grants and those because, one, I'm confident that the city council, that the design center, will use those funds for a purposeful good that's going to do something for the city, and that's going to actually drive economic development, drive perspective going forward. And so I think there's an opportunity for the city to leverage funds because of putting them in an opportunity in a situation where grants and items that the city can't really participate in.
All right, Mr. Trying to get some resolution here. Can I just make this comment, and then I'll come right to you. We've got $32,000 in the budget. I'm hearing talk of $35,900, so that means we got another $3,900 that we need to come up with, plus the $6,200 for flowers. So now, right now, we're talking about $10,100. How we pay for it, it can be another issue. But I mean, right now, what I'm hearing is we've got a $10,100 deficit. Okay, Councilmember Ahmed.
Well, I agree with if we can come up and maybe reach a compromise, have the city pay for the flowers, and come up with $30,000 or $32,000, the design center I think would be sustainable. And how we go about that by shifting the funding around, we can deal with further down. But I think that's maybe a safe direction that they should go for. And I'm very strongly believe that if in this situation this budget is falling short, and 2014, Mr. Mayor, is not looking any better because the needs that we need to meet the design centers and the City of Willmar's goal, we're going to have to fund it somehow. And it's hard for me to commit to 2014. I would like to see every budget cut and save everybody tax dollars, but I can't say we can do that right now. I am more concerned about reaching the goals and the objectives that we outlined in the performance for the downtown, and that should be our objective. I know where you're coming from, Mr. Mayor. I agree with Mr. Christensen's concept of $1,000, leadership perspectives with the financial audit that they brought for their year 2012. It shows that they have revenue. It's not a large amount of money, but I think I would much rather see the $1,000 spent to the design center. We can see a positive return on our investment. And since we're talking about leadership perspectives, they pay a fee also for the participants. I believe there's 30 people that we're affecting. We're affecting 30 people to assist in that process. How many people will be affecting with $1,000 to help the design center? I think the return on the investment would be much stronger, given that transferring or the use of that fund going to the design center than with the leadership perspectives. If that gives any direction, Dennis.
Councilmember Reese.
Along that line, I'm not sure how many, but I know that sitting at this table and also on a number of our commissions, we've got people that have gone through leadership perspectives. We have benefited from that. I would be in favor of the 35-9 and then having the private company do the flowers for $6,200.
That's the proposal that I received was $6,200.
I mean, that makes sense to me. And I would agree with Councilmember Fagerly's comments in regards to the 35-9 of the Design Center.
All right. Mr. Mayor.
At what point do we quit giving to everyone that asks?
I'm not going to be here to decide, but that will be decided probably next year.
I understand that. After 26 years, what have you done to make sure that we have enough money to pay for the Design Center?
Well, I'll comment. One of the things that we've always taken great pride in this city is how strong financially we are. We've always taken great pride in that. The bond rating agencies have seen that we're pretty frugal. So I don't think that we've spent money needlessly. Maybe we've spent some where we shouldn't have, but organizations bigger than us say that we seem to be doing a pretty good job. We've got two ideas out here, and we'll talk about how to fund the difference in a minute. I'm hearing that we see great value in what the Design Center does. We want to continue to fund them at a level that where they can function. So whether that is 32 or 35-9, that's one question. And I'm also hearing that the city's going to pick up the flowers. So that's $6,200 we've got to come up with. We have $32,000 in the budget right now. That's what's in the budget for the Design Center. Do we want to leave it there? Do you want to increase it? And I'm hearing that we're going to pay for the flowers. Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I like Councilman Ammon's idea of, you know, maybe compromising and giving them 30 or 32 grand, and then we pick up the flowers instead of the 35-9 that we.
We've got 32 in there, and I think that's reasonable. I think that's a reasonable suggestion. That we have 32,000 in there, and then the city picks up. We'll have to come up with an additional $6,200.
Can we put something in if there's a resolution or a motion or whatever that the committee comes up with? Is there a possibility that we can put in there that no future guarantees as to what the Design Center gets?
I don't think that's necessary.
I would guess that's understood.
I think that's understood always, isn't it?
Well, I think all of the groups, I mean, including Meals on Wheels and all those, understand that the budget is an annual process. And the only ones that have ongoing commitments is where we have made where the city council has made an ongoing commitment. Baseball Boosters was an example of that, and that commitment will now conclude in 2012. And then the only other one I believe that's outstanding that has a commitment to it of any length is the Humane Society. And I believe we're in the third year of a five-year commitment and such. And so we typically don't make ongoing commitments. And you resolved the other potential one with the Candio Hike Historical Society was another potential ongoing commitment, but that was already resolved.
I think you've accomplished just what you wanted to accomplish with that. Those folks are right here. They know, they've heard that going forward it's not a given. Can I suggest that we stay at the 32 and come up with $6,200, and we'll figure out how to do that in a minute. But is that the consensus? Because ultimately when this is done, the Finance Committee is going to make that a recommendation. We can't take motions from this group. The Finance Committee will do that, and then we'll move it to the City Council on Monday. But I want to make sure that these four that aren't part of the Finance Committee are okay with that, because I don't want to have a hassle and a mess Monday night.
It looks positive to me. I would support that.
Okay.
I thought, you know, you were talking about the 35-9, how it gives them the funds for the grant writer. on there.
You would rather go to the 35.9?
Mm-hmm.
All right. What would you rather do, Councilmember Reese?
I think we need to support the design center because they do a tremendous amount for the downtown.
I can live with the 32.
Okay. I think that's a consensus, kind of okay over here.
I can live with 32. Can you live with 32? And you might have to do some of the grant writing.
I'm good with that.
32 is fine. Let's make sure we get it in the minutes. So is why we're doing 32.
Okay. So noted. Okay. That's so I think for you folks, unless something happens Monday night, it's 32,000. Okay.
I got one question.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Who picks out the flowers then? Do they have a say in it?
Your wife.
I think Councilmember Fagerly, you may do that.
I'm sure, I would hope that they're flowers that will, you know, tolerate heat and will
it's called coordinate.
Bloom and grow and
In all seriousness, I would rely upon the vendor to provide something that's appropriate. But I think if anybody would like input, if anyone from the council would like input into that, they're certainly able to do that. But it would be my intent to just rely upon the vendor to provide what's appropriate.
And or if the design center knows something that works well, has worked well, you know, let Charlene know. Okay, that's we've accomplished one thing. Now, in that regard, okay, thank you, John.
Thank you.
We're done. Council member DeBleek made note of the integration collaborative to increase their funding from 21 back up to 42, I'm guessing. Is there any interest on the part of the council to talk about that? To do that increase. Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Andrews. Just a comment. As I'm looking over their what they submitted to the city, they have a employee salaries of $1.14 million. And they have three objectives in here that they put in, and I'm wondering why it costs $1.14 million. I mean, if you read what they handed out to us, I don't get it.
Well, I'm not going to try
to defend, for it.
But, you know, they do several school districts outside of Willmar.
I understand. They get a lot of government funding, too, if you look in there.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a...
Okay. I'm not defending. My question is, do we want to change the funding level from what's in the mayor's proposed budget? And if so, by how much? You want to increase it back up to 42?
I guess, you know, that's the reduction. We cut them in half from 13 to, or 12 to 13.
Okay.
I guess if that's, you know, if we don't want to support cultural diversity in the community, if that's what direction we want to go, I guess that's what you're doing. But
we have
I
enough
disagree
controversy
with that.
In the city right now the way it goes, and I'm open to some more.
Am I hearing any support for that? I'm not.
Support for?
For what Councilmember DeBleek is suggesting.
The 42,000?
Yeah. Going from 20.
I would support that.
From 21 to 42.
That was a program order. We were just going to help start it. And we were going to decrease the fund. And then they've added school districts.
What has been our history on the funding level there?
It's in the 40-some thousand dollar range. I think it was even more than that.
In 2010
was 72 grand.
2010 it was 72,000.
Yeah.
So it's been significantly cut. You know, it speaks in here I'd have to look at it, but it, the policies and of the city. You know, we talked about that a number of years ago, being able to help new residents within our community to understand the city, our policies, how services are delivered, et cetera. And they're doing that. with the minority community.
Councilman, if I can add to that and say, we have a new mayor. Get over it.
What? Oh, yeah. Explain. I'm
enough said.
Okay. I'm not hearing. Go ahead.
I was just going to say that if you look at their funding, the state is funding them $1.244 million. And if, you know, if we gave them $42,000, that's 0.033%, which is they're still getting a lot of funding. And I believe whoever said it, we were going to initially help them get going, and then I think we need to slowly move out of it, especially with the state funding that much. That's our money, too, by the way. So we're funding them twice. The state is our money, we're funding them. The city is our money, we're funding them. So I don't see any need to. I think we're being gracious in giving them the $21,000 myself.
I think there has been a benefit. There has been a benefit of what from what they've done. I believe we used that even as one of the things that when we went for the All-American City. I think that was one of the items that was touted as something that we had done in a positive manner. All right. So anyway, I am not seeing an overwhelming interest to change that amount. I don't think that the Finance Committee will be recommending any change on that. One of the other things I heard was leadership perspectives. Eliminate that funding. I'll tell you, I don't know how many others have been. I went to that. I went to it the second session. It was in like 94 or 95. It's a very, very good program. It really is a good program. So
I'd like to add something, if I may.
Certainly.
Councilman Christensen brought up a good point that they have 80-some thousand dollars?
Cash reserve at the end of the year, yeah.
Why does the city need to give them $1,000?
I suspect they'll continue the program whether we give them $1,000 or not, because the members going through the program pay a fee to take the program, and then at the end of the program they're asked if they would contribute to next year's program. So it's not something that's going to go away, but it's $1,000 that could go help whatever for our flowers or streets or other needs. It's a minor amount, but it's not necessary. I mean, what if we had 10 organizations coming for $1,000 every year, and they all got $80,000 in the bank? Now, does it make sense? Again, this is taxpayer money we're talking about. Isn't anybody else's? It's taxpayer money. So, and I think it'd be good to put that toward the flowers. That way, we only have to take $5,200 out of our $98,000.
Yes. I think the city provides staff for their meetings, don't they?
No, we do not.
The city is asked to make a presentation one time.
They may ask a council member, mayor, or a city staff to make a presentation, but that's just that would be the same as they also ask many business leaders, and there's no honorarium or anything. It's just purely voluntary, and that depends, I think, on the group that has just graduated facilitates the next session, and so they design a government day or a media day, and they select who presents. It could be somebody from the city, could be somebody from the county, or both, I think, in the past. I think so I have presented there, I have presented there, the mayor has presented. I don't know if council members have in the past or the previous mayor, but I think it just varies as to who gets asked.
It seemed like there was a staff person that was assigned in the city, but not the case now.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Councilmember DeBlick.
Yeah, I know I have presented at the Leadership Perspective program a number of times. That's an excellent program. I don't think there's any tie to what their chamber's bottom line budget is. They have a separate budget for the Leadership Perspective. I know that they've been told that before in the past. It's a program that we didn't support it. I'm not so sure it would not be there. It would be there, whether or not we supported it. I think if we pulled out of it, I don't think it's going to continue to be there.
You don't think what?
If we pulled the $1,000, I don't think the chamber will continue to fund or support that. And it's brought many, many benefits to the city. We've had, I don't know how many people that have served on our boards and commissions, and if you mentioned yourself, council member, that have gone through it and gone through the training of that Leadership Perspective program. So I think that the benefits are way outweigh the little bit of money we put into it.
Mr. Chairman.
I'm sorry. Yes, Councilmember Ammon.
Well, just a thought. I mean, you can debate this $1,000. What it comes down to is this, guys. When I asked a couple of months ago for the city administrator to have everybody come in with a budget to show how much financial worth they have, we have to make a decision just like a family does. Who has the money? Who needs the money more? It's a cut and dried issue as far as I'm concerned. It's not whether or not it's a good program. Who needs the money more? We're trying to do more with less consistently. I wish this issue was on a $100,000 issue. It would be much easier maybe to explain. But we're only talking about $1,000. Granted, they might do a fine job. I was asked to speak at one of the Leadership Perspective meetings. I wasn't able to attend, but I was honored that they asked me. When you look at this, it looks more like a payment, not a payment in lieu of taxes, or a stipend to the chamber to conduct this rather than us paying dues. Years ago, we used to pay dues to the Chamber of Commerce. And when I was on the city council, that was ended because it was in violation of state statute. It was a gray area, according to city attorney and the state attorney general's office when I spoke to them. The benefit of 30 people attending may or may not be a benefit to the city. Most business people, for example, myself, I didn't attend that. I went to Dale Carnegie classes. You can go to Toastmasters. Very little. All you have to do is bring a lunch and a small minimal fee, I think, annually if you want to be a better speaker. There's other resources out there that people can benefit from. We got a college system out here on all types of financial, if you want to understand finances. There's no end to what's out there. But for us to go after 30 people, what if 5 of these people leave the city? What if they leave the community? What's the return on the investment then? We don't know. They might move. They might not.
Okay.
And it's only $1,000. So I would look at, let's fund the sources that need the funding, like baseball boosters. People are running on a $12 or $15 checking account reserve and no balances to support any of their ongoing efforts. That's what we should be looking at.
Okay. I hear what you're saying. Does the committee have any thoughts on this?
Well, my point was the city is providing something, and it's a resource. It's a mayor, administrator, or something. I don't think we need to pay them because 99% of the people that go to the class have their registration paid by their employer.
True.
So,
either of you two have a thought?
Agree with Rick.
Yeah. I don't think there's a
okay.
Need.
We'll kick it around at the. We'll come up with a decision at the Finance Committee. It sounds like the consensus, I'm not sure I agree with it, but the consensus is to reduce the $1,000. And that'll be a topic for the Finance Committee to discuss. We're kind of hopscotching around here. Is there anything else? Councilmember DeBleek.
Have one item budget related, but maybe a labor relations issue as well. We're paying retired employees insurance. The budget amount for that is what Bill 12, it was $65,000. You've got mayor's proposed $240,000.
The retired employees insurance are basically two classifications. One of them is revenue neutral, and that's where an employee who has retired, we collect from them their portion and then pay it back out. So some of the numbers you see there are for that type of employee. There's a second type of employee, and the council had a early retirement program where they contribute $430 towards a single coverage for those that qualified. And in order to qualify, you had to have worked for the city for 20 years, and you had got, you got 1 year of credit at the $430 per month for every 3 years of service that you had worked for the city. The difference between that $430 and the total premium, again, is collected from the retired employee and is shown both in the expenditures and the revenue. The only cost to the city for a retired employee's insurance, outside of the past city administrator and city attorney, is the $430 of the early retirement program.
That is $430 on a monthly basis?
Monthly basis for single coverage.
Until they reach age 65.
Until they reach age 65 or have expired the 1 year for every 3 years of service. That's correct.
Now, I know that program, the municipal utilities participated in that, they had the same program, and they...
I believe that it was initiated, and other staff can help me, was the Candiota County had a similar program as well as the municipal utilities. Yes.
And they, their meeting this afternoon, they are going to sunset that program in 2017. So I think we need to be prudent and look at the same policy change. I know that would be a labor issue. I don't think we can, the number of retired employees we got coming up, and we need to give them advance notice that we're going to end that program, but we also need to maybe not continue to fund that indefinitely in that early retirement. It was an incentive program, not a continuing program, I think, but we never did put a sunset on it.
I have a question. Was that a negotiated thing, or was that something that the city just offered?
It is something that the city just offered. The city could sunset that if the city chooses to. It's not a part of any of the bargaining agreements.
If I recall right, the city did sunset it one time. They offered it initially, then they sunset it, and then we reinstituted it again. I don't know how many years ago, but
and we can give a,
too long ago.
Yeah, we can give a complete history. It was extended indefinitely due to the fact of, one, trying to maintain and retain long-term employees. We certainly can provide you with copies of the minutes and the policies, and that was one of the reasons why it was extended indefinitely.
Well, there is a cost. I think that's probably something the Labor Committee could take a look at moving forward.
Put it on the agenda.
Councilmember Duncan.
I just wanted to add that Councilmember DeBleek is exactly right. I attended the same meeting today, and they are talking about sunsetting it in 2017. They do have a compliance officer now. It might be worthwhile to coordinate that at some point in time with their compliance, with the compliance
officer. What is a compliance officer? I mean, that's a utility employee?
Yep.
That's designated as a...
Yep, and so...
Oh. Okay. All right. Any other budget items? Councilmember Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just reflecting on what Councilmember Ahmed stated earlier about when we get requests for funds to see who needs it and who doesn't need it. And I believe he had mentioned at a previous meeting that you were thinking of a policy. We should actually form a policy stating something of that sort. And could that go to a committee somewhere, or probably finance?
Actually, we have a policy that was developed in 1995?
Is proposed to go to the Finance Committee to review and discuss that policy.
Yeah. So I think clearly.
Not this evening, but.
Clearly there, moving forward. We've been, maybe we've been negligent, but moving forward, we're going to look at that and see where we need to go with that. All right. I think we're kind of winding it down here already. I say already. Is there anything else that this side of the room wants to bring up before I call the Finance Committee to order? Because then this side will be silent. Did you have?
Well, I don't know if it's appropriate or not, but we don't get
probably not.
Probably not, according to me. I don't know if we have 8 or 9 people together very often, but I had a request, or I'd like to make a request to have a special meeting in Labor Relations or the City Council, and I'm not sure where to go from it, how to do it. There's 9 of us here. That isn't very often, but I'd like to have a special meeting dealing with employee issues and closed meeting for Data Privacy Act, according to Data Privacy Act, to discuss operations of the city. And it takes, according to the city charter, section 2.11 procedure, subdivision 1, it takes 4 people from the council to call a special meeting of the council, or the mayor can authorize an emergency meeting within 12 hours, according to the constitution or the charter. But I just have a letter here. I'd like to see if anybody's interested. I believe it's something we're all aware of. But I'd like to just discuss it in general with the group under closed session. I hereby request a special meeting is provided in the Willmar City Charter, Section 2.11, Procedure, Subdivision 1. Reason for meeting, closed session, to discuss personnel issues. Meeting with closed will be closed to the public due to the Data Privacy Act, and Mayor Yanish and City Council members only. And I sign my name to it. It takes 4 signatures, and I just thought I'd pass it around. Whatever happens to it, happens to it.
Point of order, Mr. Chair. Are we?
I don't know if it's out of order.
I don't know.
I don't know either. I'm just calling, taking this opportunity.
I'm not sure that you can do that at this meeting. This is not a fully advertised. I'm not sure that you can. And without the city attorney present, I'm not going to give an opinion on that.
Yeah, let's hold off until the attorney can. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. We're done with that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Then I'm going to, I don't know, do we adjourn the?
We have in the past adjourned this and then reconvened the Finance Committee.
So we need a motion to adjourn the general, well, wait a minute. Before we do that, let me tell you what I've got down we're going to talk about. The West Central Integration Collaborative will see if there's a motion made to change the funding level. The Willmar Design Center will be funded at $32,000. The city will have to pick up the $6,200 for flowers. Leadership Perspectives proposed to be reduced $1,000. All of these changes proposed will come out of that $98,000 pot. And then any that's left will be, however many dollars are left, will be taken off from the $240,000. That's as I understood what we did.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
How long do we have to make further cuts in the budget?
We're pretty much done.
That's it. Mm-hmm. So somebody comes up with an idea to cut $30,000 out of the budget, can't be done after tonight?
Well, we can always make adjustments to the budget. I mean, at some point in time, we have to say, yeah. And if it's going to be a cut, and we just cut it, and then that we have extra dollars available. The budget is a dynamic, moving, changing thing. But at some point in time, we have to say, this is where we are as of 12/31. This is what our levy is going to be. This is what our budget is. So I'm not, you know, I don't know where we'd come up with big dollars, but if somebody has an idea, We can always make the changes. Is that not right?
We can amend the budget throughout the year, and I mean, and I think the council's aware that we do that. We bring budget amendments if something has not been funded, or you know, a good example would be the most recent. I mean, the most recent example that comes to mind is our LELS wage settlement, and we had to amend the budget to include those. So, I mean, a budget is a working document, but there is a, I guess, just a point of which we need to get a 2013 budget recommended and adopted, and the intent is to do that December 3rd.
December 3rd. Excellent. Okay, that's Monday. That's where we are. So I would take a motion to adjourn the
work session.
The work session.
So
second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 We get to vote.
You get to vote on this because we're closing you guys out. Okay. Opposed? All right. Now we'll call the Finance Committee meeting to order. I kind of ran through what I had. So there'll be either motions or no motions here. And I guess we don't have to record a no motion, do we? Just that we'll discuss it. And I've got the first thing I've got on my list is the West Central Integration Collaborative to increase the funding. Does anyone want to make a motion to increase the funding from the $21,000 to something up to $42,000? Okay. No action. The Willmar Design Center, leave the funding level at $32,000. That won't require any action, but because that's what's in the budget presently.
That is,
correct me
that
if
is,
I'm wrong when
that
I'm
is
talking
correct.
To the group here.
That is correct. That is what is in the budget.
Okay.
Right.
So we'll leave that at $32,000. We do have to fund the flowers at 60. Wait a minute now. The 62. Wasn't there also something about Selvig Park?
That's for $575, oh. And I mean, I think we can cover that in other professional services.
There's a trust for that.
Yeah, and there's also even a trust for that. That could
okay, be. So the flowers?
I would not be concerned about that $575.
Okay. The flowers, $6,200 is the?
Is the proposal that we have.
And it's been vetted, and it's all?
I have spoken with the vendor, and she has assured me that she can do the flowers for that. I mean, I've not utilized the vendor previously, but
okay.
I mean,
so we need to move to increase what are we increasing? I mean, 62. What account or what?
Probably professional services.
Yeah, you can.
Or don't
I mean,
you want
you
the?
Just, account, yeah, I don't
just,
think
you just
need
want
to,
the action.
If, yeah.
Okay.
If you just include the $6,200, so
we need to.
So that reduces the what it would do effectively is reduce the $98,000
yep,
now.
But
to,
I want to spell it out.
Mm-hmm.
That we're going to increase the budget for $6,200 for flowers.
I'll make that motion.
Okay. We'll talk about the reduction and where it comes from in a minute.
It's 23.
So we're going to. Somebody want to second that $6,200?
I'll second that.
Discussion.
So does that person have to get liability insurance? Or
it would just be a vendor. It would be like hiring any private vendor. I mean, the insurance and such is all upon them. It would be like hiring a custodial services or such. I mean, it's just it's essentially hiring a florist to do it.
So if they get injured, it's their responsibility.
That's correct.
It'd be an independent contractor.
Yeah, it's an independent contractor. We'd be, you know, just buying the service from them.
All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes. Okay, now we'll deal with the, we are going to reduce the 98,000, whatever it is, by $6,200. Oh, geez, I'm sorry. I went past the chamber. I didn't mean to do that. Thank you. Can we have the discussion is, do we want to reduce the leadership perspectives by $1,000?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Aye. So now then, we, assuming that passes, we will have to, we're talking, instead of $6,200, we're talking $5,200.
Correct.
Change. And that will come off from the $98,000. So we need a motion on that, and then we'll have a motion that where we want to put that 90.
On the $1,000 one you're talking now? No.
I'm talking, no.
On
the, again, I would no, handle that the same way. You're just reducing the $1,000, and yeah, I don't think you need to.
That we reduced it.
Yeah, we did that.
We did that. But now I want to say that the pluses of $5,200 or $6,200, whatever happens.
And again, if you want to round that to an even $93,000 for discussion's sake, that
$93,000.
Yeah. You've reduced the 98 by the 5,200 net.
Okay, so we're at 93,000. Well, we did that. I mean, we kind of did that action.
Yes. Yes.
Now we want to, yep. We just want now to say what we're going to do with the
$93,000.
And we're going to put that towards the $240,000 levy increase. Right? That's what we said.
It's easier to talk about this.
Someone like to make that motion?
So moved.
Further discussion?
Yeah.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes. Is there anything else?
You need to recommend the.
Oh, that's levy right.
Now.
Yes, we have to.
The levy amount you're now recommending.
We have to have a resolution to set the. I got my notes on another page. Resolution to set the levy. The levy amount.
Mr. Okins has that.
It would be $3,992,734 for the general operating fund and $147,000 for the capital improvement street.
That sets our levy. So essentially, we reduced the levy by $93,000.
Mm-hmm. I'll make a motion to approve the levy, $3,900,000.
Okay.
Whatever.
As stated.
There's a motion and a second. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes. Wait a minute. Were we supposed to include the levy for the HRA in there, or is that a separate?
That's already, action has already been taken at a previous meeting.
Okay. Then we need we're going to have a resolution to recommend setting the budget at?
The dollar amount that's in the presentation of $31,725,416. Basically, you didn't do any change in the total.
Right, in the total we did not. Is there a motion? Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes. Okay.
Is there any? Councilman Ahman's recommendation for a special meeting.
So we're not going to deal with that.
Where does that get to?
This is the Finance Committee. I can't answer that. I have no idea.
Anybody can sign this at any time. We get four people, we can call a meeting.
We're not dealing with that at Finance. Is there anything else that we need to do?
No, there are no items. There are no items of miscellany.
Wow. I take a motion to adjourn.
So
we are adjourned. Thank you.
Steve, I don't mean